Welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Phone number 866-901-ADAM. I'd like to talk to you today. I'm not sure about what, but I didn't talk to enough of you. Well, let me correct that. I didn't talk at enough of you yesterday. I'll tell you, when you talk on the radio and you have that hold button and you have the dump button, you pot people down, it spoils you. It's like, you know how you get used to your TiVo?
Mm-hmm.
Once you get used to your TiVo, Dave Damashek over there, Teresa Strasser over here. Nice to see you, too.
Word.
You get used to your TiVo, and it really does. I mean, especially if you log more hours a week than there are in the week. I don't know how it works mathematically. I'm no scientist, but I put about 15 minutes in each week longer on the TiVo than actually exist in a seven-day week. After a couple of years of that, then you go to a hotel room, you think you missed something, you reach for the thing looking for the flip-flop button there. You want to get it back a few frames. Doesn't
movie
exist.
Theater, same thing. Your mind wanders for 3 seconds. Oh, I'll just listen to what I just missed. What? I don't know what's happening.
Yes, I even do that with radio. And so when it comes to talking to people and putting them on hold and stuff, I have conversations with wives and neighbors where it's like, well, listen, I grow weary of this, and I start reaching. I reach for imaginary dump buttons. I'm going to pot them down. I've not been able to make my point without them saying, excuse me, and I'll just pot them down. I'll just put them on hold. I'll finish my point.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, people don't come with those buttons, and that's why I now avoid conversations.
I think that's best.
Yeah, it's smart. It's prudent.
If you can't control it.
As an artist, let this be your world. Let this 4 hours each day be the only four that matter.
Thank you. This will be the canvas. My tongue, the brush. Paint? Paint will be paint. See, that's the thing. They use metaphors sometimes where this is canvas. But I don't like to mess with the paint. I'll just let the professionals manufacture the paint, and I will use that stuff.
Speaking of paint. Who came up with that hideous color to put on Brusca's back today?
Wow.
Sweet Jesus, is that hideous.
Well, all I can think of is that it's darker now when we leave in the morning, and Brusca's wife didn't want him to be hit crossing the street. So I imagine
right.
She went with the iridescent blue.
Ugh.
Perhaps either that or there's some Hungarian soccer team that's in town and he's showing his allegiance. There's got to be something. It's very soccer-esque, Brusca.
Yeah, I thought lesbians wore, black and flannel and stuff.
I'm chubby. Right. I'm a lesbian. I'll get on it. I just want to be a little sporty, and I should not be taking any fashion tips from a guy who wears the same sweatshirt he did in seventh grade.
Thank you. Oh, wait a minute. That's you. Yeah, for me, it's the same one I wore Monday. I realize when I get dressed in the morning that I wear the same goddamn thing over and over and over again. And I'll tell you, part of my problem is I am like a child who just wore this jacket to church, and therefore it's not dirty because of the things you're usually doing as a child, climbing trees and wrestling out in the lawn. From years of working construction, to me, if you put on a sweat jacket, leave the house, go sit down, drink a few coffees in a V8, and then head back 4 hours later, the thing's brand new.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't hump in it. I didn't get high in it. I didn't get loaded in it.
No,
I didn't get a fight in it, and I didn't hang any sheetrock in it. It's brand new.
And beyond that, though, you contend that you have no stink.
I don't.
No BO.
I don't manufacture that. Yeah, and this is why I don't blame those who do, because it's a genetic thing, I realize. I don't have the funk.
Mm-hmm.
I will, even though, and my hygiene reflects it. I'm casual. I'm like one of these guys that doesn't have to work out, so he just eats what he wants and he doesn't work out. You know, if you looked good with your shirt off, and you just look good. You know, I have a buddy, my buddy Ray. He looks fantastic with his shirt off. He has a six-pack naturally and big guns on him and everything. So he doesn't work out.
Kid Rock, same thing, shows up in sex videos, you know, all the time. Why? Because he's pleased with the size of his wang. He
right.
has no shame about it.
Right.
Right. You, no stink, so I shall wear the same stitches of clothing
right.
on my back for 3 weeks.
Well, that's the whole thing. If, in fact, you don't stink, but you shower meticulously and put on all kinds of colognes and, you know, deodorants and stuff, then who's the joke on? If you're a guy who looks fantastic with your shirt off all the time, yet you still kill an hour a day at the gym, well, you're being an idiot, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, thank you. Somebody wants to say something. Dave?
Yeah, good morning.
What's happening?
Oh, not much. I'm driving in a downpour.
Yeah, it's rough out there.
Yeah. It's
still, though, when I hear about people that are constantly rolling their SUVs and sliding off the road and stuff, they should still be ticketed and possibly arrested. I mean, it is raining. You do realize that. And, you know, people do this thing where they use lost control of the vehicle as a viable excuse, as if they're saying the front tire blew out. Yeah. Losing control of it. Yeah, first off, everybody who gets into an accident eventually loses control of the vehicle. If you're drunk and you're doing Brody's in the parking lot of the 7-Eleven at 4 a.m., eventually you lose control of the vehicle. That's what happens. That's how you crash. So the people do that. Oh, it was just raining. I was driving down the street. I lost control of the vehicle. Well, you were speeding or you were driving on bald tires or you're doing something stupid to lose control of the vehicle. Still should get a ticket.
Yeah.
Sorry, Jacob. What were you going to say? I should say Dave. What were you going to say?
I was actually just calling in to say good morning. I love your show. I'm driving in this downpour so I can listen to you. I know that we're not working. I'm a carpenter.
Yeah.
And, nothing better to do but
wake
up to Adam.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave.
But you know what? I have to agree with what you just said on the whole driving thing. I live up in the snow, and, you know, it blows me away how many people go flying by me at 65, 70 miles an hour when it's sleeting and hailing and, you know, you see them a mile up the road spun out, you know, and they don't know why. Well, you know, I was just driving along.
They lost control, and then everyone goes, well, sure, it's icy. It's raining out here. Sure. Sure, you can't. The fog's so thick, you can't see. I know you have to slow down. I don't care. I love these people that drive like maniacs. But let's face it, if I can get a goddamn ticket for rolling through a four-way stop sign on Beechwood Canyon when there's no traffic and not a cloud in the sky, and I just physically don't technically come to a stop, I just slow it down to 2.5 miles an hour and roll through. If that's a ticket, then you rolling the minivan with the four kids in it because you lost control. Well, shouldn't there be a little ticket there, too? You had kids in the car. For Christ's sake, your car's upside down. It's in a drainage ditch.
Man. Well, and conversely, I go crazy in L.A. because everyone starts, a lot of people start driving at a crawl. Why are you driving this way? It's raining outside. Listen, no wonder people, you wonder, why do people in San Francisco and Portland and Seattle dislike people from L.A.?
Yeah.
Because they can't, it's raining here.
Now, we're pussies. There's no doubt about it. But, you know, my theory, my theory on driving is the same as my one on soccer. Teresa, you've never heard this,
I'm looking forward to it. Both are boring?
Yes. Well, the speeds we drive out here, but there's definite differences culturally in the way people drive. People like, you know, oh, that's such an ugly stereotype, but it's true. There's differences. Some cultures drive a little faster than others. Now, here's the soccer. Here's how it ties into the soccer. How it ties into the soccer is, we get our asses kicked every year in the World Cup when we go to play soccer, and people want to know, why do we get our asses kicked? We got the greatest sports country in the world. We got the greatest athletes in the world. How can we get our asses kicked every year? And then some a-hole pipes up and says, because these guys have been playing soccer for 200 years. I mean, generation after generation, they grew up playing soccer. Their dads played soccer. For us, it's a brand new sport. That's why we're just not that good at it, because none of the guys who are playing soccer for the U.S. team had dads who played soccer. Now, that's how it goes with driving, too. This is how it works. Why do all these cultures drive horribly? Because their parents didn't drive. You think about it. I grew up sliding around the back seat of my dad's VW Bug while he was hauling ass down cold water, but picking up notes.
Right,
I mean, just same as a kid. Like, you know, Tiger Woods was out on the links when he was a zygote. That's where they put a golf club in the guy's hand. You know, I was sitting on my stepdad's lap driving his GTO when I was 9. You know, this is what you do as an American. You grow up in this culture, just like growing up in a soccer-oriented culture. Thank you. Do we see any better? No. Are our reflexes any better? No. But are the European soccer players any better athletes than our athletes? No. They grow up in the culture.
How do you explain the U.S. Women's World Cup victories?
This is interesting. I wonder if women have a faster learning curve than men. I wonder if, because the athleticism part, maybe with women's sports, isn't as pronounced, that it doesn't take as many years to catch up or something like that. It's almost like for women, and again, I'm just talking directly out of my ass here because I've never really thought about this, but I wonder if women are quicker studies than men. And I also wonder if because of the nature of the sport and the athleticism involved with it, which is not quite as much, that the Europeans, that the women were ever able to bridge that gap little bit faster.
I would hypothesize that women were not allowed to play sports anywhere on the face of the earth till about 1997.
Good point.
So they all started at the same point.
Yes, there was no Bulgarian female soccer team turn of the century.
And so, can we go back to that?
So they didn't get that. So that's the exact point. Right. They didn't get the head start.
Right. I don't want to sound like a misogynist, but I turned on my TV last night. Sports, I'm on ESPN again. More of this women's college basketball nonsense. Dominates Sports Center. 2.5 hours of coverage of the game.
Yes.
It's not misogyny. It's not that I don't like seeing chicks play sports. Nobody cares about this thing. I've never heard anybody anywhere in my life say, hey, did you see that women's game last night? No one cares. Why is it on TV?
Well, I think they're further diminished when they're always called, like, the Lady Vols or the Lady Terrapins, right?
Yes. Yeah. I would argue that a volunteer is simply a volunteer, like the folks who go down to help out after the Katrina disaster aren't the Lady
That's
Volunteers.
Yeah.
Well, again, I always have to turn everything to race, but I think there's or gender. I think there's a way this country is and the way this country would like to be. And I think it turns out that way. It's that way for Black History Month. It's that way with a lot of Jewish holidays. It's a lot of, you see these all-white news organizations saying, and again, we want to thank they don't give a rat's ass. They would like to be seen as the kind of people that honor the great Martin Luther King, that honor Passover, that honor fill in the blank, Cinco de Mayo. The super white quasi-Aryan guy over at CNN doesn't give a good rat's hiney about Cinco de Mayo and probably wishes it would go away. And the same with Black History Month and the same with all the Jewish holidays.
From all of us at CBS 2.
Right.
A peaceful Rosh Hashanah.
It's Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah.
From all CBS.
That part was fine.
Rosh Hashanah?
Rosh Hashanah. Yom Kippur.
What do we got to acknowledge?
It's not Yom Kippur. Steve, it's not Yom Kippur.
I always like those guys.
It's right on
school.
The teleprompter. We have to write out phonetically.
Those people are the best, too, by the way. The ones in school when I was in like middle school, the people who pretend that, well, it's not my religion. How would I possibly know? Yeah, but you've heard of Hanukkah, right?
Yeah.
Hanukkah? What do you call it? What are you? Are you a complete simpleton? You don't know? You can't say the Hanukkah?
It's getting pretty cathartic here. Yeah, it's the same way with old people not being able to do Saddam, not being able to pronounce his name. They just refuse to it, or Seinfeld. They just refuse at a certain point. But, yes, the Goyim are that way with the Jewish holidays. But all I'm saying about the female sports is I really do believe there's a way we'd like to be perceived and a way we are. We don't give a rat's ass about the female sports and the Cinco de Mayo and the Rosh.
Hashanah.
We don't give a rat's ass about that. But, of course, you have to keep a united front up as if we do. And it's more compensation because we don't. So we have to hit it a little bit harder. Hey, how about those Lady Vols? Woo, playing on the Cinco de Mayo. Tell you what, during Black History Month,
I resent, though, that I now know.
We don't care.
There's space taken up in my brain, and I can't remove it now, that I know the name Gino Auriemma, the coach of UConn, the Lady Huskies.
All I'm saying is all you folks out there, whatever you may be, whatever your religious may be, understand us white people, we don't care. It's always just lip service. We don't like chicks. We don't like the Mexicans, the Jews, all of you. We don't care. But we'll just go ahead and pay you lip service so you think we're not feeling what we're really feeling. It's like when you go to a party and there's that one a-hole who you used to work with, who you hated their guts. You give him a little better handshake. How you doing, Herb? Good. 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 God, by cracky, you're looking good. And then you go, I hate this guy's guts. You overdo it just a little bit. Whereas the guy you did work with who you actually kind of like, you're a little more coy with. All right.
What's happening?
Okay. Yeah. It's good.
So, hey, what's happening? You like the guy. By cracky,
Yeah, by cracky means you hate his guts.
By cracky.
That explains Jimmy Brusca's welcome to me this morning. Hey!
Yeah, that
great
means
job.
last day won't be seeing you again.
Yeah, exactly.
Veronica?
Hi.
You agree with Dave Damashek?
I do. I just think that you didn't have time to think about this, but women in other countries aren't allowed to play sports, like he said.
Thank you.
U.S. women are obviously not working and, doing the lazy rapper and sports thing.
Well, they've sorted this out. Huh? Thank God.
Yeah.
How early did you have to get up to get a jump on this theory?
I was just listening and I thought about it. I thought, well, come on, Adam. And Dave said it.
No, Dave did say it, and Dave was right.
Oh, kind of.
But I will say it's also even though it's 90% what Dave said, I'll still take 10%. I think women are quicker studies. And I do think, for instance, I'll put it this way. I think a female boxer could win in female boxing with a couple years of training in the right person, whereas you couldn't do that as a male. You need to start boxing when you're 10 years old as a male if you want to win, if you want to be the middleweight champion. You can't take a 21-year-old guy, work with a good trainer, and when he's 23, he's going to challenge De La Hoya or Winky Wright or something like that. I sort of think you can with female sports, or female boxing at least. A, because the level isn't so great that there's that chasm. And then B, I think women sort of are faster studies. But I do agree, these women were sitting home being flogged by their drunken husbands or forced to, you know, put burkas on and assume the position back home. And they didn't get out very much. And
well,
that's why.
Fast study or no, I still say this, Ace. We could assemble, you and me, and three other guys, none of whom played college ball, we could assemble a team that could beat the national champion Maryland Terrapins, which I again resent because I know that Maryland won the women's national champion. The
you
Lady
don't like
Terps.
Knowing the Lady
but anyway,
Terps.
But yes, anyway, but we should do this. We'll get Ray and a couple other guys.
I would love to do that, and I would say that would have been true 6 years ago. But you
they
know what?
Gotten much
they've
better.
Stepped
right.
up. They've made quantum leaps in the last 2.5
really
years.
It's really true. You're right.
Now it's like, oh, that chick dunked the other day, and that chick dunked, and all of a sudden, the butter's off the popcorn.
Chickern.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying.
By Chippy. What was it? By Cracky?
There was a step up. There was a quantum leap forward in the last few years.
But they still do look like girls when they shoot.
All right. I just wouldn't want any of those girls jamming on me. Jacob?
Hey.
What's up?
It's early, but I'm going to try this anyway. Adam.
Carolla.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I was wondering who performed your opening song for your show.
That is the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones.
Okay. And what's the title?
Let's see. It's an old song. I think it was their first hit. I got to get to the lyrics part. Someday, I suppose. I think it's called Someday, I Suppose.
Okay.
It's either Someday or Someday. I think it's Someday, I Suppose.
All right.
Yeah. Mighty Thanks, Mighty Boss Tones. And I think, I'm thinking 1992 or 91 or something. It's very early. It's a great song.
Okay.
Do we have that?
Performed by the great Dickie Bear.
Yeah, we should just hear that. We should just hear some of that song.
It is good.
It is. Can't go wrong with the horns.
Kind of a ska feeling.
The bass in there. Yeah, and then it sort of kicks in. See, here's the whole thing, like ska. Most forms of music are best when they're sort of mixed. Now the rock part comes in. Guys wearing ties. Yeah. All right, let's take ourselves a little break. We going to do a little limerick war here, Brusca?
Yeah, pull a name out of the bag.
Okay. Lyrics are kind of good, too.
Dickie Barrett, a great performer, and an even better something or other.
What is that? What's the some? No, Dickie.
Yeah, that's what you're supposed to say. He's a great performer. And
yes, an even better father, even though he has no children. Dickie is Dickie's salt of the earth. You know, they welcomed me, the Mighty Mighty Bostons. The whole band is cool. Well, here's all you need to know about the band. They have a guy who goes on tour with them who just dances.
Awesome.
That's it. All he does
gets an equal share too.
He gets an equal cut of the pie, And all he does is dance out on stage. And it's not like he's doing the robot and popping and locking or, you know, doing the moonwalk or anything. He's not a great dancer.
Yeah.
He's a sort of clumsy white guy that
drunk.
Just sort of looks like somebody made it onto stage, essentially. He's going to have fun before. For the first 30 shows, I'm sure security just threw him down in the first row because it just seemed like he got on stage. So they're the greatest guys around, and so is Dickie. And I was out at a concert, and I just wandered onto their tour bus before I was doing anything, and they all just said, come on in and have a beer. I mean, it's easy to say, hey, I recognize that guy from MTV. Come on in and have a beer. It's another thing to say, I've never seen this guy in my life, but come on in and have a beer anyway. And that's how I knew the guys were keeping it real. All right. Now, the name I've drawn from the bag because we've been doing a little something called Limerick Wars here, which is to say somewhere around St. Paddy's Day, 88, wasn't last one. We're going back like 26 years now. We started having fun with these limericks, and they're insulting and they're fun, and they let everyone stretch their wings a little. We put everyone's name in a bag. We've been pulling them out one by one, and we're down to the last few members of the show. We now have intern Jerron is the latest victim. So, Jerron.
Blackface, white soul.
That's right. Shouldn't even use the word soul. I would just use bottom of foot. The word soul should be nowhere near. Jerron, even if he goes to a restaurant and orders a fish, just call it white fish. It's not soul. You guys are Jews, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
What's the deal with the congealed white fish?
You know, gefilte fish?
Yeah, there's one thing that we don't do as Americans, and it's one thing I am proud about with this country, is we have sort of gelatin in pudding flavors that are gelatin in pudding flavors. You want chocolate, you want some lime, you want some tapioca, fine. You want giblet flavored jello? Sorry. We don't do that in this country. Other countries will gelatinize fish.
And the Jews live in this country, though.
Country.
Yeah, it's
time to leave. Time to leave. Started in Europe. There's something. I don't mind gelatin, and I don't mind fish, but when you take the great taste of fish and you mix it with the horrible congealed gelatin,
and
it's cold and it's weird and sort of goes down like a fish loogied in your mouth.
Well, you have that at Passover, which is all about
but what do you call that again?
Speaking of enough,
Passover.
Weren't we supposed to take a break like 5 minutes
ago? Yeah,
all right, Passover. You in the ridiculous blue shirt.
Do you hate Jews?
Passover. No, I love them. I'm often mistaken for one. All right, you guys. So is today Passover?
No.
Okay. Well, that's enough about it then. We will take ourselves a little break. We will do a very American thing, which is writing limericks. That's right.
That's how we do it in this country.
That's how we do it in this country. Jerron is on the chopping block, and we'll hear about that after this.
This is Rainn Wilson. I play Dwight Schrute on NBC's The Office, and you are listening to The Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. David Zucker, the director of Airplane, Naked Gun, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Scary movie, all the scary movies. I don't know if it's all the scary movies. I think it is. He's coming in here. I got some stories to tell about him. Also, Kentucky Fried Movie, one of my earliest, not only comedic, but boner influences. There used to be boobies in movies.
Boobies!
And that's all we had. I mean, a good R-rated movie when you're 12 or 13 that had some nice boobies in it, and there's no internet, and there's no porn or anything. And also, if you could get porn, this is back in the day, but listen, kids, they had to set up, you know, projectors, and you know, it's not enough that dad was at work. Dad had to either die or leave town. Like, dad had to be in Europe on business. There was no, like, hey, my dad's at work and my mom's gone shopping. Let's watch some porn. Oh, no. You needed a few days lead time. There was setup. I mean, then there was cleanup. I mean, it took days.
Was there ever beta porn? I'm sorry.
Yes.
Really?
Yes, there is. Wow. Yes. There was beta porn. Big Tad doesn't know a world without VHS porn.
It was master beta.
Master beta porn.
Top loading.
The
Tad ate a porn once.
It is sad. Once in my desperation looking through my porn collection, I found one labeled head cleaner and thought, well, let's give this one a look. This sounds like it may be right up my alley. I don't remember this one. You know, it's funny. You could have 15 porn movies, but every once in a while you'll go through them and forget about one. And it's always the same. What have we here? What is this? Oh, yeah. Of course, you've seen it 1,000 times. It's sitting in your collection. But there's that, well, which one is this? Kama Sutra. What do we have here? Haven't seen that? Oh, yeah. And it's always right where you left off and said, oh, yeah, last time, too.
Well, that would be an awesome vigilante cop porno. Head cleaner. They're calling in the head cleaner.
I think it would
She's
be...
She's a woman vigilante cop.
I think it would be the OCD porn. Like, it just had to be clean.
Yeah.
That'd be very, very clean.
Very anal. Very anal's another good name for porn.
Write that down.
All right. Where are we?
They call that the spooge point, where you leave off your porno. You pop it in, and it's like, oh, yeah, I left it off here. I wonder, oh, that's where it was.
Yeah. I will always rewind a good, 20 count or fast forward a good 20 count. I don't care where it ends up. It could end up at a worse point, but whatever it is, you'll not be able to put a pattern together. There'll be, you cannot put all these in the VCRs and put some sort of mosaic of what kind of sick F I was. That's why I always fast forward or rewind. But imagine, I mean, first off, when I pass places that say, rentals of porn, I think, what must be up with your self-esteem, or how twisted you have to be to still endure this in 2006, and not going to a porn store to rent this stuff, going to the equivalent of the Blockbuster. There's places, that are just sort of ma and pa places where you got somebody standing in front of you that rented The Princess Bride, and there's some chick behind you that has instructional tape on special needs children, and you're there with your bangus, your anus 19. Like, really? In this day and age, we're still enduring this?
And it's always behind a curtain.
Yeah, well, that's where they keep it. They keep the porn in the back, and then there's the weird guy in there, and you can't establish eye contact with him. And by the way, it's the only place where if you bump into somebody or trade shoulders with them, you don't say a word. It's understood. There's none of that. Oh, hey, sorry. Excuse me. Wait a minute.
At my video shop.
Coach Johnson?
I'm sorry. At my video shop, they have like a slot where you pick your movie, and then you put it in the slot, and then you come out. Mm-hmm. And then you pick up your movie, and then you just walk out.
Oh, smart. Smart.
So you don't know what you got.
I'll tell you, the worst day of my entire porn renting career was renting up at a place on Ventura. It was like 2020. And again, there used to be whole chains. They're sort of separating them now a little bit. But it used to be that every video store had the porn section. Again, you'd have to commingle with the clean people, so I like to call them. I rented Bobby Hollander's porn bloopers, because for me it's like, well, what are my two loves? Comedy and masturbation. Well, here we go. It's like the Reese's peanut butter commercial.
Two great tastes.
So I thought, well, this will be funny and potentially erotic. It was horrible, but the point is I was returning it, and I was a few days late, and it was back in the day when, even again, I hate to date myself, but people also forget there were not ATMs on every corner. You, especially for me, I didn't get, ATM was like the cell phone. I got it 20 years after it had already been introduced. You'd take out $40 when you hammered your measly check on Friday, and that had to last you cash-wise. Otherwise, you're just out of luck. I was out of cash. I had to return this tape. I was 3 days late. I dipped into the change bucket in my truck and was paying a handful of nickels and quarters. And the chick behind the counter I went to high school with, and it had only been 2 years since we'd graduated. How's it going? And Carolla, well, you do the math. Here's a bucket of nickels. Here's Bobby Hollander's porn bloopers. How do you think it's been going, sweetie pie? You see the Mazda? You see the beat-up Mazda truck out in the parking lot? There you go, baby. That's your chariot.
Not going to buy you a lemonade?
Yes.
Most right. likely to succeed in late fees for the
That's
porn.
Right. With pay, most likely to pay with change. All right, where are we? Yes, Jerron, everybody, in our Limerick Wars. Jerron, how say you?
Oh, I'm not ready for this Limerick War yet.
Oh, you're not?
No.
Emotionally, or
yeah,
do you have
I
to prepare
don't think I can
something?
Handle it.
You can't.
No.
Good.
By the way, he's sick too, and as a trooper, he came in.
Are you, Jerron? What do you have? Sickle cell? What do you guys get?
I don't know. No, I want to be educated.
educated.
It could be
hypertension. I would like to be educated. Let him talk. I like those people do that. They say something horrible, and then they go, I'd like to be... No, tell me. I want to be educated. What do you people get?
Oh, we get everything. We get diabetes.
Hold on. Let me write that down. Diabetes. That's why a lot of you older ones of you don't have legs.
Exactly.
That's true.
Exactly. Okay. We say our sugar's bad.
Okay. We'll write that down.
Yes.
That's diabetes. And these guys over here, they have the Passover.
Right. Right. Okay. It's infectious.
Sir, hold on.
Passover.
I want to learn. Yes?
Passover.
Passover.
Correct.
Passover.
Right. Very tolerant.
Passover. Okay. You guys have the sickle cell. You guys have the Passover.
Passover. And we get TACS. That's one of our diseases.
That's a disease, TACS, too. So you can't. Okay. All right. Keep going. I want to know more. So you get the, you say the Suge Knight?
Glaucoma? We get that too.
Glaucoma?
Yes.
Okay, there's another one.
I was smoking pot. You know all the rappers. Snoop Dogg?
Snoop Dogg. Yes. I don't know that name. Let me write that down.
It's not with a Y. It's just S-N-O-P-P.
Okay. You know? And what do you have now then? Do you have the glaucoma or do you have the Snoop Dogg disease?
Bad sugar.
I probably have the bad sugar.
Bad sugar?
Yeah, some type of virus they said too.
Virus.
Yes.
I think we get those too. So there is some common ground here.
Just a little
okay.
bit.
All right. All right. So you came in anyway. That's the good news, right?
Yeah, I can't miss a great payday, you know.
Yeah.
The pay's great.
Drove all the way out from Pomona. We will then make fun of Jerron in the form of a limerick. Let's see. Please, someone help me. I'm going to always try to start in sort of reverse order of how I went last time. You went yesterday?
Yeah, Damashek's never started. Why don't you start Damashek?
So be it. But it needs to be clarified ahead of time that, you know, Jerron, while on the to the naked eye, is a black man.
Mm-hmm.
Within.
No.
He's white as a cracker.
That's true.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Now, with that in mind, I shall begin. If intern Jerron were a coat, he'd be a white mink fur. White like that wig on the head of Aaron Burr. He's got less soul than Dolphins running back Larry Zonka. Paler inside than Johnny Depp as Willy Wonka. Less like Latrell Sprewell, more like Steve Kerr.
Wow. Wow, that was really... advanced. Yeah, a lot of analogies.
Sports.
Interesting.
Just like American Revolution.
History.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, the unbeaten Miami team of 72. Right.
Too much, though. Too much.
Yeah, it was a little...
Too much.
Like I said, that was a little artsy, not enough fartsy. A little too much artsy, not enough... An interesting try.
It was clever. And who? And Brusca.
Too much.
Speaking of the Dolphins, you have an uglier shade of blue on than they wear when they go out on the football field.
Let me say this before you can levy a lesbian response. let me say what that was to me. That was, you know, on Thanksgiving, once in a while, somebody tries to do their own take on the stuffing.
Mm-hmm.
But they go, well, it has the bread and all that kind of stuff. But what we do is we take currants and we take golden raisins and we take walnuts and we mix it in. And you go, oh, okay, yeah, and some dried cranberries. It's a delight. And you go, yeah, I'm hearing you. I'm feeling you. And then you take a taste and you go, I like the old one better.
Complex, yet not ultimately
right,
as satisfying.
Ultimately didn't,
as the,
yes. Yeah, somehow can't explain it. On paper, seems better. Complex, as you say, sounds good. I'm willing to try. But you know what? Now I kind of miss it, the old way. Next year, go back to the old way.
All right. So
based on the old way being good.
I'm going to just have to, to resign myself to knowing I gave 110%, and that's that.
That wasn't a metaphor. I'm talking to you about stuffing, Dave.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I didn't know you. Back to Thanksgiving.
Yes. All right. Let's have Gay Board Op, Pre-Op, Board Op, Bill.
Sure.
Chime in.
There once was an intern named Jerron, and if you talk to him on the phone, he sounds blonde. Brusca won't let him into the meetings. Seems his time here is fleeting. Too bad for me, because he's lean and quiet and dark and long.
Wow.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you.
Oh, true. You could check all those boxes. And then you could check your rounds. All right. That was nice. A little stumble, little fumble.
Yeah, I got interrupted.
That's all right. Yeah, but you interrupted yourself, so that doesn't count. Interrupted
still.
By you effing up.
But still.
Yeah, but still. Okay. All right. Got to write these scores down, by the way. All right. Who's next? Mike, you want to go?
Sure. I'm also sick, so you'll have to forgive the delivery.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you about intern Jerron. He acts and talks like he's blonde. The man has no soul. Though he's black as coal, he's as white as a beautiful swan.
It's kind of lyrical.
Yeah, lyrical, and one would argue not really an attack, which is all right. We work different angles on this show, but I think there's a reason why limericks are insulting, and after you hear one that's sort of even-handed, you realize, nah, it's always funnier to be insulting. You think you're going to pick a new path, this will be an interesting twist on it, and then you sort of miss the old stuffing, as we talked about. All right, who wants to go next?
I'll go.
Big Tad?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Jerron, the only whitest black guy I know. When he tries to rap, he doesn't know how to flow. He gets happy when he hears Vanilla Ice. He should be listening to Obi Trice. When he tries to talk to When he tries to talk brother, he blows. I stumbled.
Yeah, you're doing. Yeah. Speaking of a flow. Yeah. You're doing great.
I'm white.
No, that was a wonderful routine. That was like I'm watching the ice dancing, and here comes the guy. Here comes the Canadian who wasn't ranked any higher than the top 20 over his long career. Now at the end, his last Olympics, and he's put together an amazing routine. Stumbles at the end. Right at the end. Big fat ass hits the ice.
How dare you?
All right, I'm sorry.
I'll go next.
All right.
Jerron the intern is black but thinks he's white. He's so girly, he can't beat Peter Pan in a fist fight. But at work, I love Jerron. To his work ethic, I say, right on. Too bad he wants his skin color to be very light. Jerron, please say, dynamite.
That was so white.
Oh my God. That was atrocious.
I'd like to follow that.
Wow. Hold on.
Always the best strategy.
Let me ask you guys something, because I didn't go to college. And I've heard it both ways. Is there, in fact, a number lower than zero? And if so, how do I draw that?
The first two are supposed to rhyme, Bruska. White and fist fight.
All right.
How did it not rhyme?
Okay.
Please.
Okay.
Let's not rehash.
Teresa?
Yes, thank you. I'll only benefit by following that.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Jerron, I know I've only known you a couple days, so I apologize in advance. Jerron gives the show much needed color, though he thinks 50 cent is what you get back from a dollar. He has all the street cred of a Grateful Dead head and looks surprisingly like a Brigham Young scholar.
Mm. Solid. And in a sea of mediocrity, your 7.5 is shining like a star, like a beacon. But we save the best for last, which is phone screener Brian. Ryan?
Sweet.
How say you?
By the way, Jerron, a genuinely nice guy. Very hard to come up with stuff to attack him about.
Yes.
Let's go, Baldy. Make with the rhymes.
Make with the funny. Jerron's an Oreo with no soul. Despite skin that's as black as coal. In spite of his nappy head, we get no street cred. Maybe he should be a real brother and violate his parole.
Very.
Salvaged it at the end.
Yes. But now the Oreo part, isn't that half and half?
That's the black on the outside and white. I should have gone with honky.
Oh, is that what that is?
Black on the outside and white on the inside.
Oh, I just thought that was 50-50 mix thing. Did it get originally used that way?
I always heard it as the black on the outside and white on the inside.
Interesting. You're probably right.
Did you craft one?
I did, but you know what? We're running late, we will do it when we come back.
Ooh. So be it.
Yes, all right. And then I will deliver the bad news to most of you. We will take a quick break. I will give mine for Jerron. Then we have Christian, our 13-year-old comedian, right? Yeah. He's calling in. He's going to see if he can make an appearance over at the Improv here.
News,
sports. Who else do we have? Oh, we got later on today, we got the crazy woman who's, you heard of these people that go to the soldiers' funerals and protest? Basically, the guys who die overseas for this country come back and get buried, and there's this whole fanatical group that goes out there, religious fanatics, that basically says America is a breeding place for queers, and anybody who protects this country deserves to die. So basically, you folks who got blown up with the makeshift bomb over there in Iraq and are now coming back to have your remains scattered somewhere over this great land, we'll just stand outside the funeral with a big sign that says die fags, and you know, this is what you get, and God hates you, and God killed you, and all that stuff.
It's marvelous people.
Wow.
It's delightful. I think it may be performance art. Also, Def Frat Guy is going to be part of the show. Always excited to see him in studio. Comedian Dane Cook, all coming up, along with my limerick after this.
Yes.
stand. His bitching is getting out of hand. He eats like a pig. His jokes we don't dig. Thank God he's about to be canned.
Wow. That's it.
All right. Phone screener Brian is a huge nerd. His penis is smaller than a bird. Punches like a sissy, acts like a missy, and his breath always smells like a turd. Word.
Wow.
Tad is a fat mama's boy underachiever who is kind and friendly and loyal as a retriever. His panis hangs out, he'll probably get gout, and his hairy belly button looks like a beaver.
Nice. I'm going to give you some extra points for working panis in. Mm-hmm. Panis is that part of your belly that slops over your belt buckle that guys have. It's really a great look. Nothing better than going to the gym and seeing the guy with the mammoth panis. Mammoth Panis. That's a good name for a rock band. Mammoth Panis. Yeah. Who'd you guys tour with? Mammoth Panis? Oh, yeah. Here, those guys are good. Saw them do an acoustic set over at the Knitting Factory. All right. We have more limericks to go, including my own. Also, Christian, 13-year-old comedian, is on hold. Hollywood, big-time director, David Zucker, Airplane, Naked Gun. Many of the movies I've gotten... You know, it's one of these things I'm trying to think. You don't necessarily think of the Naked Guns or the Airplanes when you got your highfalutin hat on. You know, you like to think, you know, people say to you, oh, comedies, you go, Annie Hall, just because you want to say the right thing. It's like when people ask you, what are you listening to? Radiohead? So you don't want to tell them you're listening to Savage Garden. You seem like a lightweight. But... in terms of enjoyment, laugh for laugh, smiles to your face when you're sitting at the movie theater in front of your TV set, I would say the Zucker Brothers movies have brought me more smiles, more laughs over the last 15, 20 years than just about anything.
Sure. Now, listen, some people say, what's the funny? Annie Hall's my favorite. So some like It Hot's my favorite. Some people go Caddyshack. But these pictures, you know, Airplane and Naked Gun, there's nobody on the face of the earth that doesn't enjoy these pictures.
That's everyone loves very true, and I've seen them all a million times. And then, of course, you got the whole Police Academy thing.
Ah, yes.
That's the TV series. Mike?
Yes.
You have a limerick about Geron?
Yes, here it is, sir. There once was a man named Geron who couldn't keep his hand off his wand. He would jerk it and stroke it, prod it and poke it, when all he really wanted was some lady to smoke it.
Nice. But here, let me tell you what that was. That was like you going into a shop that said custom tailored suits, and you walked in and the guy handed you a suit and said that'll be $149, and you said, yeah, but where's the custom tailoring? No, this one's for you. And you thought, well, don't you have to take a measurement or something, Pops? No, this fits.
Yeah.
No, that's not custom tailoring. You can't have a limerick if you could pop Geron's name off and go ahead and put, I was gonna say board up Bill's name on there, but forget that. Brian doesn't like ladies. Yeah, okay. Lesbian.
He's into the chicks.
Mike's kind of asexual.
I'll have to do.
Hey, if you could put Damashek's name in front of there, do it like maybe it's not as easy as I thought. But you know what I'm saying. Maybe this was a bad example, this room. But if you could pop Geron's name off and in place put someone else's name and it works just as good, that's not a limerick. That's one size fits all.
Yeah, shame on you, sir.
Yeah, those
for
are
that
those
attack.
That was not a custom suit. Those were elastic sweatpants, my friend. That's right. That was a gym sock that did the fit size 6 through 28.
Now, Ace, why don't you show them how it's done? You have a limerick prepared, yes?
I do. Yeah, except for I don't have my last rhyme. I had to do a live rhyme. Here, you guys
get
help
an
me.
Extra 15 minutes.
I know. Give me something. I was talking. Give me something that rhymes with bite. Oh, let's see. Fight.
Right.
White. White.
Night.
White. Already got white. Night.
Ignite.
Right.
Shug night.
Okay. I got it. That's right.
White.
Right.
Midnight.
All right. I got it now. All right. I think I got it now. This could be a little lumpy, but let's see how it goes. I wouldn't say intern Geron acts white, but he makes David Hyde Pierce look like Suge Knight. All right. He wears flip-flops. He's never heard of hip-hop. If he interns for the Klan next, it would serve him right.
good.
All right, a little
good.
Bumpy.
That's good. I like
David Hyde Pierce maybe should have gone with two names there. Yeah, but a very white man.
I think that should have been your closer.
I think you could have
Should have closed with that.
Your strongest
That's
stuff.
Right. You're right. I worked backwards on that one. All right, let's go over the scoring. Thank God I don't include myself in that group. Dave Damashek. Did you start, Dave?
Yes.
7-6.
That's crap. I had Steve Kerr, Mink Fur, Willy Wonka, and Larry Zonka.
Do you
That's
wanna,
awesome
do you
stuff.
Do you want to do it again?
No.
Okay. 7-5, by the way. You want a 7-4? Keep going. What happened to parents doing that to people? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're getting a timeout for 20 minutes, young man. All right, make it 30. Huh? Yeah?
But I'm
45. You want to go for an hour?
Oh.
Yeah. What happened to the ratcheting up? All right, Bill, 7-4. Big stumble at the end. Mike, 7-5. All sort of mid sevens. Big Tad, 7-1. Who do I got? I got two. Oh, yeah. This must be Bruska. Bruska, 5-3.
What?
Sorry,
oh,
buddy.
And that's also his height.
And coincidentally, this is our last day.
Yeah.
Wait a second. Just a reply to Dave who said I didn't rhyme. White, fight, light, dynamite. Which one doesn't rhyme?
Do you want to do yours again? It's not all about rhyming.
I know, but his point was I didn't rhyme. They all rhyme. I don't know what his problem
is. I'll give you another shot at it.
Please turn his mic on. Take
another shot at it, and let me see if we can raise the score.
Jerron the intern is black but thinks he's white. He's so girly he can't beat Peter Pan in a fist fight. But at work I love Jerron. To his work ethic I say right on. Too bad he wants his skin color to be very light. Dynamite.
Well, it's just like Peter Pan isn't really a contemporary reference.
It's not like the topical David Hyde
Pierce. Peter's Bruska shirt.
All right.
Here's 101-102 right here.
I'm moving you up.
Flowed.
I'm moving you up to 6-1. That's because I'm in a good mood. All right. Now, who do we have? Teresa, 7-7.
Wow.
Nice job. Brian forgot to write anything down. Brian did a solid job. I think it's Teresa's last day. I'm giving this one to Teresa. I'll call the tie. They both got 7-7s.
Thank you.
Teresa's going to take home the trophy here. Nice job, sweetie pea. Now, where were we?
Zonka Christian. And Wonka.
That's right. Wow, running late. Christian?
Yeah.
You're 13. You're calling from up north. You've been calling the show. Well, this is probably the sixth or seventh time you've called in. You called in. Well, I'm not going to count the first couple of times when you called in and told us jokes. And we said, you have potential, but we'd like to hear it from the heart. We don't want you to be up there like Shecky Green or the guy who plays the fiddle and tells me to take his wife. We'd like you to hear more conversational stuff.
He's gone from caterpillar, just reading books reading jokes out of a book, to now he's becoming a burgeoning comedian.
Right.
Yes.
Henny Youngman.
Right, writing his own, crafting his own jokes.
The ironically aged Henny Youngman. He's 91. Still staying with Youngman. All right, Christian.
Mm-hmm.
So now you're putting together material from your own life.
Yeah.
Let's hear it. What's today's topic?
Today's topic is it's about me. Just me and my family.
All right.
All right. I have a big family. I have 4 parents, 12 grandparents, and a hell of a lot of cousins. But none of them are like me. I'm like the black sheep in the family. But I think my dad is probably the most different from me out of my entire family. He's athletic. No, he's not great with computers, and he loves a home-cooked meal.
Mm-hmm.
Me, I'm lazy. I spend most of my time with computers, and the closest thing I've had to a home-cooked meal is In-N-Out. But you never would have guessed this, even if you had met me in person. But I'm half Lebanese.
We are.
Yeah.
Didn't know that.
It's from my dad's side of the family, but mm-hmm. I don't look Lebanese at all. My dad even had the dominant genes. He had the black hair, dark skin, and brown eyes. I have blue eyes, blonde hair, and I'm whiter than a Klansman's dream.
I like that.
But I'm part European and I'm part Native American also. So technically, my ancestors killed my other ancestors hundreds of years ago, which is kind of weird. But
yeah, it's funny.
My dad's got a good sense of humor, though. He named me Christian Jihad Tayar. I know you know probably Jihad means holy war. But what you probably don't know is that Tayar in Arabic means pilot. So I'm Christian Holy War pilot, and after 9/11, I didn't have to worry about getting bad grades. I'd get an A-minus and be like, do you know who I am? I don't look Lebanese. I don't look Lebanese, but my dad does. I'll call him over. I see my dad. They see a tall, angry Middle Eastern guy. They're like, I'm sorry. No. That's it there.
All right. Now, of my couple of notes, but A-minus, you know, maybe you should have said C-minus or D-minus. You know what I mean? Before you have to get your dad in there to start screaming about Allah.
I like the, I thought that the material about some of your ancestry killing the other part of your ancestry, that's something to mine there. I think there's a lot there.
I like that too. I think it could have been tightened up and maybe, you know, you guys are funny. Maybe you could help with the, I'm half Lebanese, I'm half Indian.
Yes. That's right.
Someone gives me a jihad and I take it back or, you know.
Right. I don't know whether to get loaded or scrape some lamb off a gyro rack.
It's close. Or
whatever it is. Yes. I know what you're saying. Yeah, you need that kind of thing. I think what it is, Christian, and it was a note from last week, which is you started off doing the jokes and we said, get away from the jokes. Be more conversational. Maybe it's too conversational now. Now, it's funny. It's interesting, but it's almost like spoken word at this point, which is to say that you sit back and you watch this guy tell his story. But it's sort of like public radio on weekends. It's not. Now we need some laughs because if you're doing your act in front of a crowd and they're in a club, you have to be conversational, but you need the jokes at the end of each conversation.
You have to provide obvious points for the dopes out there in the audience to laugh
at. Punchlines.
Right. Punchlines, yes.
Punchlines that do not have traditional setups.
Yes.
You know, and that's the key. And to make it feel as if you're just talking in your conversational voice, but there's all these punchlines that are sort of secretly woven in to your conversation. So nice job.
He's progressing nicely and he's got about 5 weeks. Am I right? Or exactly 5 weeks to the day that he's going to be at the Improv in L.A.
Right.
With a show. Headline, you know, he's headlining it along with Jeffrey Ross. Yes,
that's
superstar
right.
Superstar comedian.
I would see that. He's a very talented young man.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, you're not talking about Jeff Ross, are you? But that's talent. No. Okay, so Christian, call us back next week.
All right.
Think punchline.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And also think exploration, which is to say, you know, it's funny. You're half Lebanese, half American Indian. You did that joke where. Your ancestors killed the other ancestor. Now, one more joke about it.
Explore that, yes. The two sides of you, of your mind,
right.
Attacking
you
each
don't,
other.
You don't
right.
need to move on to the next topic after that. I'd like to hear a little more about that. But whatever the joke is, explore it a little more.
Okay.
All right. And it didn't rhyme.
May 11th, right?
Yes.
At the Improv.
10th or 11th?
May 10th.
The 10th.
I will go see that.
Damashek being wrong, I can't believe
I was so limericized that I really, for the first 10 minutes, I was like, when is this kid going to put together a goddamn rhyme?
Or talk about how...
I'm going to hang up on him. And by the way, I've not heard Jerron being white at all in this entire bit. Oh, man, am I stupid. Hollywood director. Big Hollywood director. By the way, do we have to write down Hollywood director? Just say director. All right.
Now we're nitpicking.
I would disagree, Hollywood. Where were you from, Idaho? This is my mom's friends.
Tomorrow I'll put that Idaho director.
Hollywood director David Zucker, he does those skits. He does those long little skits with his friends. They make them into things called movies. Great Hollywood director David Zucker is coming in here, the mastermind behind Airplane and Naked Gun and Police Academy and Scary Movie. We'll talk to him about all that after this.
Can you fly this plane and land it?
Shirley, you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley. We're running out of time.
Shirley, there must be something you can do.
I'm doing everything I can. And stop calling me Shirley.
The mastermind behind that, David Zucker, in studio. No, it's you, your brother, and Abrams, right? Who are the sort of threesome behind all the classic Airplane movies and Police Squad and Naked Gun and all that good stuff, right?
Right. We started out in Milwaukee back in 1971.
I believe, and you were also behind Kentucky Fried Movie, right?
That's right, which we did as a kind of a result of our theater that we did on Pico Boulevard in L.A. in the early 70s.
Yeah, it was sort of that. That was your, was it the Kentucky Fried Theater or something, or comedy troupe or something you guys had?
It was a live show, and we did live skits, a sketch show on stage with portions on video that we would show. Satires of commercials.
I got to tell you, I was really heavily influenced by Kentucky Fried Movie. I've probably memorized that movie. It's probably one of the only movies I've actually memorized. And it's easier to get a 14-year-old to memorize things when you sprinkle boobies in every 10 or 15 minutes. It's nice.
Well, we found that visuals were a help.
Yes, and great... great boobies in that movie, by the way, and funny vignettes. The Cleopatra Schwartz was great. Was a send up of, I guess, the Cleopatra Jones movies, except for she marries a rabbi, and it starts off with she was 6 feet of black dynamite. He was a short Hasidic Jew. And there's a great line in there that goes, "While she burnt the ghetto to the ground, he kindled the Sabbath candles." And there were match made in heaven, these two taking on ghetto crime.
That was one of the things that we didn't do on stage in the Kentucky.
Well, it worked in the movie form. Also, one of the handful of people that saw Police Squad, which was actually on TV as a series for like 8 episodes or something like that, right?
It was actually on for 4, and then they couldn't take it off fast enough. It was it got such low ratings that they pulled the last 2, so there were 6 made in all.
Wasn't there... Oh, 6 made in all. They pulled it after 4, and there were 2 more that were sort of floating around.
Yeah, and they showed the following summer.
Right. But that sort of had, in a certain sense, wasn't that almost like the Family Guy in a certain sense, that it came out... obviously, didn't run as long, but people really loved it. But the man pulled it off the air. But in subsequent years, you found out that a lot of people really dug it.
Yes, it was the evil TV network. It wasn't our fault at all. I like to say that. I mean, all of my flops were, I think, ahead of its time.
Yeah, well, that. Yeah, but just, that then I, spawned
I have
all
not
the
done any failures. Yeah.
That spawned all the Police Squad movies, right?
That's true. Well, we went back to it years later, and we thought, well, that we still think that this is funny, so let's do it as a movie.
Yeah.
Oh, really? So it was. Because I remember watching Police Squad and just crying watching it, loving it, and then I just assumed somebody came to their sense and said, "We must make a movie of this." No, that you stuck with it and said, even though no one liked the TV show.
Right. Well, certainly. Yeah. No one ever came to us.
Really? How bold?
Well, we were always kind of stung by the failure of Police Squad, because we really thought it was funny, and we thought, well, it just wasn't right for TV, or was ahead of its time. So,
well, considering when it hit the airwaves in 1981, The Dukes of Hazzard was the number one comedy on TV.
I remember we were up.
I mean, think about the sensibilities of this country. For the love of Christ, Dukes of Hazzard in the comedy department is consistently top 5.
You can't compete with that.
No, you can't compete with stupid. When you're smart, you can't.
We were up against Magnum PI and Fame. That's what I remember.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but a lot of people said that they really loved that show. I mean, it was remembered.
Yes, it was. And then, again, brought back. And I imagine it's on DVD somewhere, right?
They're now planning to put it out on DVD, and we're going to do a commentary in the next few months.
For the original
Police Squad 6 episodes.
6 episodes. Well, they're very funny. And like I said, the movies... And here's the thing, too, about that genre, which you guys sort of invented, that I don't even know what to call it. What do you call, let's say, the Police Squad airplane comedic genre? What would you call that?
Well, they're calling it spoof. I mean, the whole spoof genre.
Right. Yeah, it is a spoof. And I guess you continue that with Scary Movie, by the way, 4, which we're here to talk about. But not only is it a spoof genre, there's a sort of, I don't know, it takes it a step further than spoof. I don't know, it doesn't seem like enough.
I think you're right. It's just, it's better and more brilliant than just that.
Spoof shouldn't be a word, by the way.
Yeah, it's like, spoof's what are we
a
talking
sound.
About? Yeah,
spoof's something, that's a noise you make when you drop your cat.
Yeah, I'm not giving myself enough credit.
You're not, you're a genius.
Yeah, what can
What's
I say?
What's the, of all the, between Naked Gun and Airplane, all the spectacular lines. What's the one that you're sick of hearing? People coming up to you and repeating to you.
Well,
you know, I'm not sick of hearing any of them because usually if they're coming up to a line, you know, they're not holding a knife or anything. So,
right.
So it's except OJ, I guess.
Yeah.
But that, you know, the, yeah. There's any, you know, it's from usually it's Don't Call Me Shirley or Nice Beaver or that line from Airplane 2 that I don't recognize because I never saw it, but. but they're always there's a million lines, I guess.
What was it like
Shirley
working?
Can't be serious.
There you go.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley.
What was it like working with the Juice? Good guy.
He was a good guy. Yeah, I was one of the people who were totally surprised by, you know, how all the murders worked out.
Yeah.
But
you thought Kennedy would have done that before the Juice, right?
Right. I just I was completely surprised, except that. You know, one time on the set, there were certain indications that maybe he had a temper or something. And, I mean, I used to do this this Howard Cosell, where Howard Cosell was saying that Juice was crying on the phone and, mm-hmm. and all that stuff. And so they convinced me to do it for OJ, and I did.
Mm-hmm.
And he was really angry. He said, "Never happened, man." It was
not amused.
Yes, man.
You did Cosell's halftime highlights for Monday Night Football for the Juice.
Yes.
With the Juice.
And they said,
not amused.
The Juice was crying on the phone. I told Emmy to talk to him. I couldn't take it any longer. So, yeah, and that was the bad imitation. But everybody thought that because of I was the director, people would laugh.
Right. So, yeah. Doesn't work that way. I've learned.
But
if you had your own radio show, people would laugh too.
Yeah. Well, you have your laugh track, so that's.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. That wasn't it, but thank you. That
no
was
one bombs
legitimately
on this show.
Funny. I think you also directed a movie called Mafia. Is that correct? Wrote and
no,
directed?
That's actually, no. That was Jim Abrams.
That was Abrams, but yeah. Not a Zucker Abrams.
That was not a Zucker Abrams. We kind of the last
or Zucker.
Movie,
sorry.
The last movie we directed together was Ruthless People. In 86.
Ah, Bad Blood.
And then we went to, what was that?
Bad Blood between you and Abrams?
Oh, no. We just went, my brother and Jim Abrams and I went kind of our separate ways after
mm-hmm.
not wanting
because
to direct.
Because of the Bad Blood.
Well, because we hated each other.
Right.
Actually,
right.
All teams
yes.
eventually.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. Look at the A-team.
You thought you could get some conflict in this, but.
Yes.
No, I'll say we hated each other. And mm-hmm. so we split up and, no.
So that was an Abrams.
But in fact, we're still working.
Zucker.
Jim wrote part of Scary Movie 4. So,
oh, he did?
Yeah.
So is everybody a billionaire 1,000 times over?
It's never enough.
I know what you're saying.
Yeah.
But.
You think, but see, yeah, billionaires, but then we keep buying bigger houses. So,
yeah.
You know, it's just, I'm always scraping for money.
No, you have a monthly nut.
No matter what your level, you're at my level or even at your level.
Yes,
I'm sure
literally
you
a millionaire.
Find sometimes you have to, yeah.
Yes, no, your nut gets so big. Plus, you get a lot of, well, let's just call them pilot fish stuck to the side of your shark that's swimming
that's
along.
Right.
You get a couple of friends.
I'd rather you call me Dave.
All right, a couple in-laws.
And suddenly you have an entourage. And
you got an
entourage.
You
don't know where they came from.
Right, and they got SUV payments to make, and you're going to jump in on that one. All right, what the heck are we doing here? So you're not good, because I'm glad.
No, we're all friends, and Abrams did Mafia, and Jerry did Ghost.
Okay.
So, yeah, so they did.
Shall we hear a little clip from Scary Movie 4, by the way? We have,
I'd like to have
that queued up.
Teenage gang thefts, the go-go girls who go too far. They all talk, fight, and love just one way. Dirty, underage, oversexed. Girls who won't take no for an answer. Teenage gang tips.
Is that?
That's from Airplane 2.
You did. You grew up watching a lot of that stuff, though. And when,
yes.
when I saw, like, Kentucky Fried Movie, there is an influence of those kind of old movies, a sort of retarded early 70s, late 60s.
Absolutely. We, you know, when the way we got to Airplane and the Naked Guns were by watching those old movies. That's what we thought was funny, not the comedies at the time. So
right.
Airplane was kind of a way of almost making the audience feel that we had redubbed one of those straight movies.
Yeah, I mean, the funniest movies really are you, Chuck Heston in a bong circa 1972 watching him, you know, pull his aviator glasses off sort of sideways and go, "Sweet mother pearl," you know, like it's straight as he possibly can.
Theater.
Yes.
And we would have the most fun, you know, those nights with, you know,
sure.
whatever
drugs.
Yeah, you make your own spoof.
Yes, we made our own spoofs, and then we found a way to make a living out of it.
There you go. All right, well, Scary Movie 4 hits theaters April 14th. David, thank you for coming in. We appreciate it.
This is fun.
Kick Abrams in the nuts for me.
I will. Thank you.
Just trying
He's
to start
a very
things
nice
up.
Guy.
Well, you have to say that. Scary Movie 4.
But my brother is not a nice guy.
Yes, he's a piece of work. April 14th, everybody. David Zucker, thank you very much. We'll be back with news and sports after this.
She was 6 feet of black dynamite. He was a short, ascetic Jew. She fought a savage battle to stay alive in the ghetto. He studied the Talmud at night. While she burned the ghetto to the ground, he kindled the Sabbath candles.
Yes, a little Kentucky Fried movie for you. See how good we are over here? Not so good that we would have it before I talked about it, but a few breaks after I brought it up. Funny stuff.
That was by Hollywood director?
Hollywood director, David Zucker. All right, we need to do some news. We need to do some sports. We have the crackpot woman who goes out and protests at the funerals of fallen American soldiers, calling them, I don't know, fag savers or something like that.
Classy lady.
Classy lady. We'll talk to her a little bit later. Also, deaf frat guy in studio. Always a treat. Dane Cook calling into the show. Much to do. First, I want to say this. You know, as David, as you know, I'm obsessed with the USA Today snapshots.
Yes.
USA Today is the only paper I read because it's basically the paper equivalent to a Sullivan book. It's essentially for retards like me who don't really like to read. I like to see pictures and color and little blurbs. And if I got to drop down to another line, it's not for me. There's too much text on the page. Either if you can't do it all in one straight shot, forget it.
Big bold headline or not at all for you.
Right. Well, what's going on with Jessica Simpson? That kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to read about what's going on in Beijing or, you know, nuclear crisis.
Fallujah.
In North Korea. What was that place?
Fallujah.
Okay. Yeah, and I don't even want to know what that is. The point is I don't want to know. That's why I read USA Today. I am obsessed with their snapshots. These in every section of the paper, they have that little corner with the graphic. And sometimes they're interesting. Sometimes their batting average is about as good as Peanuts was over the last 15 years, which is, yeah, one out of every 6 months is funny. The rest, you got nothing. Mm-hmm. And you have to read it before you realize you got nothing. And sometimes if you're like me and you're dumb, you have to read it four times because you think, well, there must be something I missed here. Let's see. Lucy's sitting there. Lucy's sitting at her psychotherapy booth that's out in the middle of the pumpkin patch. Charlie comes by. She says nothing. He says nothing. Six captions later, I got nothing. And all I'm saying is, look, obviously it's a tall order to do these snapshots or do these cartoons. There's many days when you just have nothing. Put a picture of a missing kid. Mm-hmm. That's
right.
All. There's plenty of missing kids.
Useful.
Just say we got nothing. And by the way, who's going to complain? Where's my useless pie chart about nothing, about airplane travel and people sleeping in airports? They just sleep for 22 minutes in 1963, and now it's up to 29 minutes in 2006. Does anyone miss that pie chart of nothing? Put the missing kid in there. Let me give you an example. This is four. I'll give you three out of four from today. First off, here's an interesting, hard-hitting graphic. You guys sitting down?
Yes.
Here's something you may not know. Coming out of the gates with a win. Current streaks for the most consecutive opening day wins in Major League Baseball. Orioles have six. Cubs, are you sitting down? Four. Again, brace yourself. The Rockies have three. The Tigers have three. The Dodgers have three. And the Brewers, three. Three wins. Wow. So you're telling me these guys have won the first game for 3 years in a row? Incredible. And the idea that the Brewers and the Rockies and the Tigers and the Dodgers would all have three, it's eerie.
Well, it's also valuable information because, you know, when you say Brewers and Rockies and so on and so forth, you're talking about the elite of baseball. Obviously,
sure.
It results in World Series championships.
Sure, yeah. Mortgage the house and bet the farm on the Brewers this year, everybody. Because you can't win your first game without going on and running the 162-game table
right.
After that.
You can extrapolate a lot of data.
Here's, you guys think you're floored by that nugget. A dig on this. This is entitled, another snapshot, Google galore. Number of books published about Google.
Wow, it's meta.
Yeah, yeah. This is a problem that has been haunting man for years. You got to know. I stay up nights trying to think the number of books.
How many?
Oh, I'll tell you right now.
I need to know.
In 02, zero.
Zero.
Nobody wrote any books about Google. 03, 13.
Big change.
04, staggering 27. And 06, 26. Down one from 2 years ago.
What is there to write about Google, though, by the way? What happens if you Google, though? Do you, like, go into a vortex? A spinning?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes, you fall into the hat that the guy fell into in Lidsville. And you see the groovy gooly. Or the, what the hell's the name of Charles Nelson Reilly's guy? The hoodoo guru, I think, hits you. All right, so again, by the way, what is there to write about Google? What is there to write about writing about Google? That's the real goddamn question here. All right, here's the next one. Yes, ready to retire. Here's an interesting graphic. Percentage of people confident they will have enough money to live comfortably throughout the retirement age. All right. Now, 2004, people ages 50 to 64, 72%. But people ages 65 to 74, 78%. That's 2004. Now we move forward to 2005, 50 to 64 is 70%. So it's essentially the same. And then 81% in 65 to 74. It hasn't changed. By the way, we don't need charts and pie graphs if things are essentially the same. If they're just draw a flat goddamn line, would you? Here's what you have to read. And all I'm saying, you got nothing. Obviously, when you're doing books about Google, you have nothing. It's a tall order to do a snapshot every day
right,
and put
right.
a missing kid in there.
Right.
That's all I'm saying.
Thank you.
The more you know. The more you know. Thanks. All right, now we're running way behind. Go ahead. What do we have? We have news? We have sports? Let me say this about our producer, Bruska, Hollywood producer, Bruska. You want to know what his favorite part of the show is? The part after the part that I'm doing. Whatever that part is. No matter what I'm talking about, he slides me a note and says, get to the next one. If we're at the end of the show, he says, get to the end of it. If we're at the beginning, he wants to go to... If we're not doing the news and sports, he wants to get to the news and sports. If we're at the news and sports, he wants to get to the next one. I understand that.
All right,
it's called being progressive.
Why don't you be in the moment?
Well, two things.
Live in the moment,
one
dude.
One is I like to push it along. And number two, I just want to make sure you know where to go next.
Oh, I know.
You always ask me, even though I have a crop.
Bruska, why don't you produce a decent shirt out of your closet? That shirt that you're wearing is hideous.
Produce yourself a less blue shirt.
All it's a great show.
All right.
A lot of
why don't you try and do a funny sports? And
All right. Let's see if you could do just one.
Wow.
Teresa Strasser here filling in for Rachel Perry with the news.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
News. Big news in news.
Mm-hmm.
Katie Couric announced this morning that she's leaving the Today Show to take over the CBS Evening News. NBC reportedly has an offer out to Meredith Vieira to replace Couric and co-anchor the morning show with Matt Lauer starting in May. Let's hear Katie Couric making her big, big announcement after 15 years this morning on
the stage. Once in a while, we get on each other's nerves. Well, he gets on my nerves. But I could not have asked for a more talented partner or better friend. And just as Dorothy said to the Scarecrow, I think I'm going to miss him most of all.
Mm. Is that Matt Lauer?
Yes. Do you think he'll be okay without Katie?
I think he probably hates her. Everyone who works with each other for more than 10 minutes hates each other in Hollywood. That's how it goes.
Is that really a better gig? I guess you don't have to wake up early is the main
point. No, it's beyond that. She's going to be the first female solo anchor to helm an evening newscast. So it's...
Yeah, but so what? It's not like every barrier hasn't been broken in this day and age except for president. And let me say this about Matt Lauer.
Please.
Because I was watching this with my wife the other night and she said, Matt Lauer, he's good looking man. What happened? He was at the top of everyone's sort of hunk list when he hit the news or when he hit the morning show about 5 years ago. Now never hear about him anymore. It's all Brad Pitt, Matthew McConaughey. I said, that's because he started talking. And we discussed this metamorphosis that goes on in the minds of women, that once a guy becomes less than a chatty Cathy or more than a chatty Cathy, he's done with in their sexual minds. Better to be sort of quiet and stoic. I believe guys like Brad Pitt get a ton of mileage out of just looking great and never talking. Let women do the math. And when they do the math, it's, oh, he's an architect, he's a doctor, he's a family man. He wanted to have children. That's why he had to get away from that anchor, Jennifer Aniston. He's a loving man. I have the feeling that if Brad Pitt spoke every morning for an hour on national TV, women would be through with him, and the same with Matthew McConaughey, and the same with all the sexiest guys in the world. Because eventually, they would just start blabbing, they would realize that they're not that intelligent, they would start putting their foot in their mouth, they would say things the women disagree with, and they would become human beings, and the women would wash their hands of them. And that's what happened to Matt Lauer. He made the mistake opening his mouth. And I can tell you, if I was on Good Morning America, I would not say a goddamn word.
Just sit there and look pretty.
Adam, what do you think? Well, Jesus, you gotta say this whole Iraqi thing's gotten out of control. Mm-hmm. Even throwing it to guys, like if I had to throw it to weather, it'd be like, and they Willard Scott would just do his thing.
It would be compelling, at least for a little
yeah,
while.
Yeah, right? I know.
And women would be going insane. Yeah. I got to get him to talk.
Right, because I need to know what's going on inside
that
shell.
What's he thinking?
Show.
What's
Who
he
is
thinking?
He?
There's so much there. The reality is that the guys that don't talk don't have anything to say. That's why they don't talk. The good-looking guys who don't talk. And by the way, you know what I like? If you're Big Tad and you don't talk, you're stupid. If you're Brad Pitt and you don't talk, you're smart. You must be thinking about something very important.
Complex.
Yes. No.
Now, but in the meantime, why is Katie Couric? Is she substantial enough to
Here's
do the news?
I'm going to tell you.
Mary Hart was busy?
Yesterday, or the day before, Adam said something which I thought was very astute, and which a lot of men think. He said, women hate other women.
Yes.
Katie Couric has somehow managed to escape that fate. Women
right.
love Katie Couric.
Yes.
So that's why she's worth millions and millions
that's
of dollars.
That's true. They won't turn on their own.
They won't turn on Katie.
Right.
Okay. Tonight, one of the final nine will be eliminated on American Idol. And if you've ever wondered how it feels to have to sing after you've just been voted off, which I have, here's recent cast-off Kevin Covais on The Ellen DeGeneres Show discussing just that.
It's difficult in a sense, but when you watch it at home, like anyone watching at home, I know when I watched in past seasons and saw people do it, I was like, wow, how can they do that? I'd be crying like a baby. But when it happened to me, you know, you're kind of in the moment and you know it's your last chance to show America what you're made of on the show. And, you know, you just kind of put everything aside and, you know, I just wanted to be a man about it and do what I had to do. And I did.
No, man about it. He doesn't have a pube yet. Don't worry about being a man about it. Focus on being a teenager about it. Yes. Man does not have a pube. Oh, police, Crimea River, 16-year-old, dream shattered.
Maybe you should have spoken less and just been cute like Matt Lauer.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, on to more serious news. Saddam, back in court, a strange day in court in Iraq. He was grinning and unpredictably he broke into poetry.
Why do I grin? It is because I do not walk alone. My Lord and Savior Jesus Christ walk with me.
Fantastic.
And now a limerick about intern Jaran. There once was an intern named Jaran who liked to smoke weed from a bong. He's such a big honky, he got less soul than a donkey, and even Uday had a bigger schlong. I joke, but seriously, Udo hung like a black rhino. You know, he gets it from the old man, yes.
Wow, Uday hung.
What do you give that limerick of Saddam?
Jeez, I give it a 6.3.
It's cool he's listening, apparently, from his jail cell.
Big fan.
Yeah. It's also cool that he found the Lord. Lots of seems to happen. You go into the clink.
Yeah, well, let me ask you this. Every single person we throw into the joint over here stateside finds the Lord. How about some of these terrorists we throw into Guantanamo Bay? They seem to stick with Allah. How about you guys find Jesus Christ? Mm-hmm. Be a lot easier on us.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's a good plan. Where is, and the Lord seems to only reside stateside. He's out here at the maximum security places. We need to send him abroad. Send the Lord over to Guantanamo.
Some people feel the Lord is everywhere.
Send him to The Hague.
You know, speaking of the divine, Mother Teresa, there's a planned biopic about Mother Teresa. Who do you think maybe would play her?
Well, I've heard it, so I won't say anything.
An Indian director was hoping that Paris Hilton would take the role.
Oh no,
He was attracted. That's so hot. He was attracted to her virtue because she refused to pose nude in Playboy, which is pretty much like helping leprosy babies.
By the way, Paris Hilton thinks a biopic is a super comb. She thinks it's a super hybrid type of comb that some prototype comb that she wants to get hold of.
She's like, can you do my hair and make it look hot with a biopic?
Yeah. Look, these people aren't serious. They just do this to get some news, right?
Yeah, well, I think so. I mean, and it is because it's an interesting news story, and hence I'm talking about it. But he also said that not only did he feel that Paris is virtuous, but also that there's a striking facial similarity between Paris Hilton and Mother Teresa.
Yeah, sure. If Mother Teresa was still alive and you had your choice between receiving oral between Mother Teresa and Paris, it would be a coin toss.
But I think Mother Teresa lost her teeth at the end.
Oh, all right. Well, a compelling point. Now
anyway,
I'm going Mother Teresa.
That was Mother Teresa. I'm Teresa Strasser. That's the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Ruskin, in his blue shirt, has given me that windy clock thing that he does with his finger, which means be fast. So I will try to be brief. National pastime. Only 160 more games left to enjoy. Mm. American League. The Angels got tagged by the Mariners up in Seattle. Oakland beat the Yankees. National League. Giants and Padres were rained out in San Diego. Mm. Rain out in San Diego.
Yeah.
It's the first since 1998. The apocalypse must be here. The good news is, though, the fans are going to have 2 days' worth of pent-up boost to rain down upon Barry Bonds when they take the field today. Dodgers, meantime, shook off the raindrops courageously to beat the Atlanta Braves. The Bums' new first baseman.
Well, did you know 3 games in a row they've won opening season?
Wow.
3 games.
As opposed to other teams.
Well, the Tigers in Milwaukee. I mean,
ticketed for a world crown this year, no doubt.
You, it's got to happen.
The first baseman, though, of the Dodgers, Nomar Garciaparra on the DL. Not shocking. He has not been healthy for more than a week straight since Little League. NBA, Kings of Schwarzenegger lost. Still 2 games up for that last playoff spot in the West. The Clippers, LA's best team, came back from 22 down to beat the Nuggets. By the way, over the weekend, the Clips clinched the first winning season since 1893.
Really? They were playing back then.
That's right.
Who knew?
Dante Culpepper, formerly of the Minnesota Vikings in their little sex boat escapade, has been cleared of all wrongdoing. The judge bought his story that he wasn't pawing any of those strippers slash hookers because he was in the back shooting dice. And as I said before, is there a better advertisement for craps than that? Yeah. I know there are naked girls doing unmentionable things 15 feet away, but I'd rather be throwing those bones.
Yeah. That is a great advertisement. Yeah.
Yes. Did you watch the ESPN reality show about Barry Bonds?
No, I didn't see that.
Bonds on Bonds.
Wow.
You know, it's everybody thinks he's a jerk, you know. He's a terrible guy. He's an awful creep of a man, a cheater, a liar. It turns out we were all wrong.
Hmm.
He's a sweetheart of a man with a heart of gold. Here's a little bit of him talking about how much he cares about the money.
I don't need their f***ing money. I don't really care. I've never really cared about that anyway.
Fine, then give me some, you creep.
Wow.
Stinking liar. Yet another lie.
Oh, you're only saying that because he's black and you're white.
That's the only reason. The media targeted him. America targeted him just randomly. We chose his name from a hat.
Yes.
Who shall we make the jerk of America? May as well be Barry Bonds.
Yes.
Yeah.
I agree.
Filthy creep.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right, running behind. We're going to take a break. We have the crackpot on the phone. That is the woman who goes out and protests at soldiers' funerals. Religious zealot. Signs like, I don't know. Basically, her assertion is this country harbors homosexuals. And by you guys fighting for this country, you then become a friend of Satan. Because you're essentially fighting a jihad for a country that's waging an unholy war against Christianity or something. However it works. She's on the phone. We'll talk to her in a second. Also, Deaf Frat Guy on the way, too, in a never-ending series and attempts to get on this program. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
This is Deaf Frat Guy. Give Adam a call now at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. Deaf Rat Guy coming up in just a couple of few.
Continuing effort to get hired, right?
Yeah. I think he's done some news for us, or he did some weather reporting for us and some traffic reporting, some financial reporting. I think he's going to do a health report.
He went out the spring break.
Right.
Remember that for us.
50-year senior. He's a teak over at USC. Yeah, go Trojans. He's going to come in here. I would say, by the way, no slight against all the other funny people on the show, but Def Frat Guy, far and away the most popular guy on the show.
Mm-hmm. Yes? Yeah, definitely. I agree.
I'm excited to meet him.
Oh, yeah. Well, be careful what you wish for, lady, because he is going to be all over you. He's a typical frat guy.
Definitely more popular than Damashek, by the way.
Yes. Wow.
Go ahead, please.
No. I won't repeat what I said during the commercial. All right. Now, where were we? Yes. Speaking of smart, Shirley Phelps-Roeper. She's located in Topeka, Kansas, is part of the program now. Shirley?
Hi.
Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Now, you're a member of the Westboro Baptist Church.
Yes.
You're the folks that we've seen all over the news. Your father's Fred Phelps Sr. He's the pastor of the church. You guys are attending funerals from our fallen soldiers and holding up signs to say, thank God for dead soldiers.
That's right.
That's you guys. Why?
Well, because the wrath of God is pouring out on this nation.
Mm-hmm.
And our job is to cause America to know her abominations and to put the cup of the fury and wrath of God to the lips of this nation and make you drink it. Mm-hmm. That means we've got to be timely and we've got to be topical.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do it so that you connect the dots.
You can't go out and protest the Hindenburg victims, for instance. You got to do stuff that's happening now.
Well, of course, that's timely and that's topical.
Right, I understand.
That's where you live. You see, God is dealing with us where we live. He's reaching down into all the little communities, down into the little families.
Mm-hmm.
It's America on the ground who lives a filthy manner of life and flips him off on a daily basis
mm-hmm.
and will not obey.
Right.
So,
well, I'm with you. And then how do we do that? Because I may be doing it myself.
You mean how do you obey or how do you live a filthy
manner
of life?
Well, what are we doing that's offending God most?
Well, it's a nation of idolaters.
Mm-hmm.
Look, first I would direct you to the signs of the times,
mm-hmm.
esignsofthetimes.net.
Mm-hmm.
There are all these picket signs. You can click on one, and there's a little video that will explain. But I'll tell you shortly, this is a nation who serves itself. These people in this nation worship the flag. They worship the works of their own hands.
Mm-hmm.
They worship the military. They worship the dead. The idols are many and varied. Think Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
And so on.
Yeah.
And then you've got a nation who is awash in sin. I'm talking adultery. The Lord Jesus Christ said, if you divorce and remarry, you are living in adultery. And you know that people change spouses in this country about like they change their undergarments.
Mm-hmm.
And you also know that besides those kind of adulterers, they're the kind that are sneaking around like dirty rodents.
Sure.
On their spouses.
Yeah.
You also know this nation is awash in fornication.
Mm. That's why I moved here.
It's a mock of sin
that
you do all this. You're kind of a freak in this country if you don't have sex before you're married.
Mm. All right.
And if you get married just so you can have sex, if whatever, anything that's proper, the standard was set by the Lord your God,
mm-hmm.
it's this. Marriage is honorable in all, and that bed is undefiled, and every other sexual connection, God will damn in hell forever.
Sure, this may sound like a stupid question, but are you an atheist?
Well, that is a stupid question,
no.
Considering that I'm talking to you about the judgment
okay.
of God.
I didn't know, because sometimes I'll say God damn or Jesus Christ. I'm an atheist. I'll still bring up his name a lot, but it doesn't have the same context.
And of course, the best way to deliver your message is to go to the funerals of dead soldiers.
Well, if the weapon of choice, if one of the weapons of choice that God is using to punish this nation,
mm-hmm.
killing your children, sending them home dead in the battle, of course our forum of choice has got to be those dead soldiers' funerals.
You're on the side of Al Qaeda and the people that are killing our soldiers?
I'm on the side of serving the Lord your God. I'm on the side of warning my neighbor that his sin is taking him to hell.
Well, let me say this, Shirley. I'm down with you serving God, but I would argue that it's better to be a better way to serve God by going down to the soup kitchen or
why
heading.
Why don't you do that?
Well, I'm not interested in serving God. That's your That's your
well,
thing.
Well, then if you're not interested in serving him, which, of course, that's clear by your words and your deeds,
mm-hmm.
but I'm saying if you're not interested in serving him, then where, from what basis do you launch off to tell me what would be the good way to do it? Here's the way you do it. Mm. You crack a Bible. If you say you're going to serve God, mm-hmm. and this nation calls itself a Christian nation, then how about if you crack a Bible and read his word? Mm. How about if you see what he
says? I'm not interested in serving God, though.
Yeah,
that's my point. Well, I know, and I'm sure you crack a Bible. What I'm suggesting is instead of going to the funeral and offending the bereaved, parents.
About that, they offended the Lord their God, and furthermore, what you're describing is not serving God. That's serving yourself. That's your form of righteousness. I'm going to go to a soup kitchen and make myself feel better because I've given someone something to eat.
Yeah.
You know, you can do that, and you can serve God. That's not serving God.
You know,
that is.
I'm just going off. Hold on a second. I'm just going off on a jag here. They ought to have pastrami kitchens. I would swing by one of those.
Yeah.
Yeah, soup kitchen. I'll keep driving.
I like soup, but
Soup's
7 days
fine.
A week, enough already.
Where's my pastrami kitchen?
Right.
For that, I'm pulling over, getting in line.
I hear you.
All right, sorry, Shirley.
I rest my case.
What is your case again? What case?
The case where I describe for you that you make a mock of your
right.
Case.
Well, let me ask.
Mockers and scoffers.
Let me ask you this. I'm, by the way, not a mocker or a scoffer. I'm a naysayer. Mm. We're a different group.
You've scoffed.
I've scoffed and I've mocked, but that's only on the weekends.
Uh-huh.
My normal gig is naysaying.
Yeah.
So Shirley, let me ask you this question. You believe, and I hear this a lot because I know a fair amount of religious people. It always seems they always believe that they're living in the time when the end of time is coming, when they do that thing where they go, just turn on the evening news. We've got hurricanes. We have, dirty bombs. We have soldiers falling. We have global warming. But every 100 years, the same thing was said, and yet it was never the end of the earth. Do you know what I'm saying?
Well, I know that you are an unbeliever. I know that you're incapable of connecting the dots.
What does that mean? What does that mean for him, though?
I'm answering.
Mm-hmm.
Lord Jesus Christ said, you hypocrites will look at the face of the sky and you'll talk about the weather, but you will not discern the signs of the times. It's easier to discern the signs of the times because, he tells you, mm-hmm. as it was in the days of Lot, they ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. You know Lot.
Sure.
And then when Lot went out of Sodom, he destroyed them all with fire from mm-hmm. heaven. And those conditions will be existing when the Son of Man returns.
Well, the point is that Adam, I don't think you're going to get to go to heaven, is what she said.
Yeah, because you are a scoffer and a mocker.
If you wanted to go to heaven, you would go to some funerals of some dead soldiers.
Yeah, and where bereaved parents are crying,
yell at them.
You would yell. Because
so if I got one of those die fag signs and showed up at Arlington with you.
You punched your ticket to the heavens.
Right.
Uh-huh. I just cracked the Bible, and in Matthew 5:22.
Hold on, we have Gay Bill over here. Shirley?
Uh-oh.
Hi, Shirley. I just cracked the Bible, and in Matthew 5:22, Jesus admonishes the people outside of the temple, calling the brothers and sisters raka, which in Aramaic is sort of a slang for faggots. So he admonishes the people to stop calling the rest of the people raka. And that's in Matthew 5:22.
That's right.
New Testament.
He said, don't call your brother. Mm. He said, don't call your brother. And he says, don't do that unless you have a cause. Mm-hmm. Read the words,
and No. He says that you will actually be sent. He said you will be subject to judgment and not the people that you're calling raka.
All right. Shirley. Shirley. Let's really get to the. Let's not argue over the Bible.
No, let's
Shirley,
argue
can't be
over.
Serious.
Let's
well, I would. I'm trying to do a radio show. Let's really. Let's
oh, you
just
mean
that's
get inconsistent with being being honest and.
Let's, Shirley, please. Could we get to the? Could we get to the crux of the issue here?
The crux of the issue is you don't read the Bible and you don't obey God. Now he is kicking your ass, and you think if you contend with me over that it'll change it.
Right.
It doesn't change anything.
Yes, the dear Lord God has been very brutal to me, my mansion and my sports cars. You who live in a house
vanity.
Clad in aluminum siding, God has been
and
great to you.
Gone
Listen, let's get to the real issue. When were you molested? Because obviously something was done to you.
Yeah, someone touched
obviously her. Somebody pulled you into a basement and did something horrible to you. Well, be honest.
How about this? Let's be honest. The Lord my God set his standard in the earth, and I am going to strive against sin, and I am going to do my
obviously,
warn my
Shirley,
neighbor that his
Shirley.
Sin has taken him to hell.
Hold on 1 second. You know what I love about this country? Folks like Shirley over here are free to fornicate, raise their kids, and have as big a brood as they like. If you, obviously, she's mentally unstable. If you spoke this way about Napoleon, you'd be carted off to a padded room somewhere. They'd not let you around your own children. The idea that you can have this sort of religious zealotry and not be looked at as a crackpot in this country is insane to me as an atheist. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Shirley suffers from, we're making fun of her.
She's
an easy target, right. But she's clearly mentally ill. But if you're clearly mentally ill and you replace whatever with religion, then you're not mentally ill anymore. You're just very committed to your religion. Mm-hmm. I look at it as a mental illness. Shirley.
Did you freaks cut my mic?
No, we did not cut your mic. And by the way, it's called a telephone, not a mic.
Whatever. Did you turn it off so that when I spoke, you couldn't hear me?
No, that was your Lord God Jesus that did it.
No, I think that was you. And if you do it again, I'll just hang up.
Oh, boy, that would be tough for us.
Well, you called me. I didn't call you.
That would be difficult for us.
So
for
what
you
do you want, guys? What's your point here?
You have a mental disease, obviously.
Yeah, that changes something. Now, how about if we address the issue at hand?
Right.
That's the wrath of God. You tell those people over in New Orleans.
Let me explain something, Shirley.
All is well.
I'm sorry to tell you this, but there's no God. You're going to have to wait until you die to find that out.
Yes, that
but
would be
people like you have been crowing about God for 2,000 years, and he never comes. You go up to the mountain, you set up the folding chair, you pack the Coleman because he's coming this weekend. He never comes. He never comes. He never comes. He never comes, does he?
I don't believe in heaven or hell, but in this case, I really hope that there is one, so she can burn
Shirley,
for eternity.
Shirley, let me explain something. You're a disaster.
You, words, you think if you talk really loud and fast, that'll somehow change the fact. Mm-hmm. Malachi said, "You wearied the Lord with your words."
Oh, he was scary.
Change of fact.
To the corn.
Shirley,
Malachi was the scariest bad guy in that picture.
You say there is no God and that God loves everyone. You guys are in the former group. Mm-hmm. There is no God. You're a bunch of, you know, when you say there is no God, you're a liar and you know it, and the scripture says you're
no, I don't know it. And here, I gave you your retarded ambling piece. Now give me mine, sweetie P. Look,
what do you want?
Are your grandparents alive?
My grandparents?
Yes.
Well, some of them are.
Some of them are. But you have ones that are old and have passed away, probably from AIDS.
Probably
now listen to me. They were born and they spend their entire retarded life proselytizing about God and his return.
No,
and guess what? They didn't come back and they're in the ground. And their parents and their nutty parents and their nutty parents and your whole nutty family talked about Jesus coming and Jesus' reign and Jesus and the second coming.
You know,
and they're all in the ground.
And
where's Jesus?
And they don't care what you're doing. No matter how heinous your behavior is at these funerals.
Yes.
They don't care one way or the other because they're dead. And in 5 years, they'll still be dead. And in 500 years, you'll be dead with them.
That's right. Hopefully it's less than 500 years.
Our message is for the living.
All right. You're right. And it's a positive one.
Keep his commandments. That's your duty. Obey. That's all.
Okay. You're confusing your dog, by the way, who's nearby and wants to know why you're yelling obey.
Can I ask Shirley a question? With all due respect and, cracking the Bible.
Right. You got a lot of that. Go
well,
ahead.
She is a Jew.
I am a
so
Jew, but
consider
please hear
the
me
source.
Out. I'm sure you'd like, I'm hiding
you're
my
sure
tail
what?
And horns.
You're sure what?
I just wanted to say that I admire a lot of Jesus' teachings, especially the golden rule, which is
no,
to do unto others. And
no,
I wonder
you
if
don't.
You'd like people
right,
showing up
on,
at your funeral.
Hold on. Listen, Shirley, hang on a
protesting.
Second.
Protesting.
First off, let the Jewess
speak.
Finish her compliment about your Lord. Could you please?
I'm saying something nice about
could
Jesus.
Could you please? Do you have to jump?
She'll burn for eternity soon enough.
Right.
Yes. Let her speak her
it's
peace.
It's bad enough I have to eat gefilte.
Yes.
Now I'm saying
this.
The golden rule,
and
do unto others. No, Shirley,
Ezekiel
just give me a chance
had to
here.
Eat human dung to convince those people of how filthy they were.
Yeah.
Shirley, you can't be serious.
Ezekiel and Danny
Shirley,
Kay.
I'm just saying that the golden rule was one of Jesus' best teachings, and I wonder if you would mind people showing up at your funeral
I'd be sorely
protesting.
Disappointed if they didn't.
Right.
Sorely disappointed.
Right. And they would replace the word fag with hag, but it'd be the same sentiment.
One last question. One last question for Shirley. Did you see Will and Grace last night?
No, I don't watch Will and Grace.
All right. Hold on a second, Shirley. I'm quickly falling in love with you.
Hang she on a second. Hot.
And seriously, when we come back, tell us the molestation story.
I'll tell you about my 11 children, if you'd like to know about that.
Oh,
perfect. God. Perfect. All right, hang with us, please, Shirley. She's, where's my card, by the way? Didn't I have it in front of me here? Did you take it?
No.
All right. Well, anyway, they're a nut job religious sect that goes out to the funerals of American soldiers and says, thank God for dead soldiers on signs. And that's got to be so dynamite hideous for the bereaving right parents. All right. We will talk more to Shirley after this.
I work for the Adam Carolla Show, and I'm supposed to be out here looking for crazy people. Prove to me you're not crazy.
The crazy question is that everybody in London is going to win. Now, the Queen Elizabeth is really on the throne, and we're going to win the Mercy Act of the Throne Bowl. And we're going to go back to scripture number 48. That's not crazy.
That's not crazy?
That's interesting.
Are you telling me you're not crazy?
I'm telling you that you came from an old time, but not in my era of love. When my dad is going to win, he's going to take it all. And the word is not crazy. It's called Krishna.
Krishna. That's my name when I used to do magic. Sad that the Bible has essentially turned into a Sears catalog for nut jobs. It used to, I think it had some meaning at some point. Now only screwballs read it.
Right, before and literally interpret it. Everything in it, yes.
Yes, all right. Shirley Phelps-Roeper. It's funny because I look at Shirley Phelps as sort of old school, but she has a hyphenated last name, which would suggest she's a little more progressive than...
Contemporary lady.
Yes, she's a woman of the times who just likes to go out to funerals of fallen soldiers and hold up signs saying, thank God for dead soldiers. She is on the phone with us. She's in Topeka, Kansas. She's part of the congregation of the Westboro Baptist Church. I think I should plug her website real quick.
Why not?
She's been on hold. She's been doing a nice job with us. Church website is godhatesfags.com.
It's I don't know how she got that domain name.
Yeah.
Can't imagine.
Yeah. godhatesfags.com. Hey, next time I do one of my live AMCO reads, please, if I get confused, you know, and I go, if you want to reach them on the web, go to God Hates Fags. Jump in.
Right.
Because, you know, sometimes it's early for me. Okay. So, GodHatesFags.com. And really, pretty much the group believes that you're just going to burn in hell if you're against the Lord. And also, they're one of these groups that believes that God sort of does everything, like the Hurricane Katrina, 9/11, that was just God punishing.
Right.
Punishing.
Well, and they hate specifically with this. They hate the U.S. of A. because they feel that it's a breeding ground for homosexuality. We don't do enough as a country to push down the homosexuals.
We're fag enablers.
Enablers, yes.
That's right. Shirley?
You got it, guys. You are fag enablers, and you're some of the most. But you know what occurred to me while I was waiting here? If you guys don't like our sign that says, thank God for dead soldiers, thank God for Katrina, thank God for Rita, thank God for 9/11, if you don't like those, we got a new sign this week, and we'll be out tomorrow in Washington, D.C., where the United States Taliban is meeting to try to dismantle the First Amendment. We've got to worry you guys a little. But anyway, we're going to pull out. We got a new sign. We're going to go after we leave the state capitol, the United States capitol. We're going to go over to Walter Reed Army Medical Hospital with our new sign, because we figure if you guys are trying to pass laws at this hour to make us stay away from funerals with our thank God for dead soldier sign,
yes,
what we need is a new sign and to help you remember our job.
So you're going to Walter Reed Medical Hospital.
And we have a new sign. And
that's
you know
where, now wait, Mena, hold on, just for clarity, that's where the soldiers will be who have lost limbs
wounded
and are horribly burned and things like that. All right, this is going to be good.
It's not only killing the soldiers that is a punishing hand from the Lord.
Sure, you want to maim.
But it's maiming them. So you can imagine our new sign is going to say what, guys?
Well, I'm trying to think what rhymes with
for the Lord.
I was molested.
Maimed soldiers.
Thank God for maimed soldiers.
Exactly.
You see, clever. The arm of our God is not short.
It doesn't right. have a ring to it.
Be able to get you to see and understand. Mm-hmm. If you're not going to listen when we tell you thank God for dead soldiers, mm-hmm. and you're going to pass laws to try and say, oh, caterwauling around, it's so grievous. You know, those families that you're so sympathetic towards, they're the right. ones who raised that child for the devil and sent him straight to hell, cut off before his life mm-hmm. barely got started at the hand of a raging mad God, described in the scriptures as having smoke coming out of his nostrils and fire coming out of his mouth.
Maybe he did a bong load.
Get your attention, then maybe what we'll do is get your attention with thank God for maimed soldiers. And what words would you throw in the air when you try to pass a law to stop that?
You're throwing names in the air?
No, what words will you throw into the air when you try to pass laws to stop us from saying that?
Yeah, I don't know that you can throw words into the air unless you ride them on like a Frisbee or a Nerf ball or something.
You guys are throwing a lot of words in the air, and you're going to give an account for them, by
Kevin?
The way.
Kevin? Oh, yes.
You think all you got to do is say, I don't believe in God, and that's going to keep you out of hell?
Yeah.
Or are you ever in for a
I believe in God, but I'm a Jew, so I'm still going to hell.
Yes, you will.
Well, you don't believe in God. That's why you're going to hell, not because you're a Jew, silly.
Would have been nice if he...
that you're a Jew. It says, confesses your sin that you rejected Christ.
Would have been nice if God had intervened while you were being molested.
I know. Couldn't God have just stopped Uncle Sammy from touching you
yes,
in your dirty place?
You wouldn't have been scrambled as an adult. Would have been nice.
Now you want to go down the trail of talking about my... And by the way, you keep talking about that I'm this and I'm that and blah, blah.
Just the molested
part. I'm also a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And the lawyer part of me is the part that helps me to understand that this nation deserves to give away their freedoms at this hour because the Lord your God gave you that First Amendment. You didn't appreciate it. You have no respect.
I didn't know
for
you
it.
Could get a law degree from a community college.
Yeah, what
sure,
law school?
I want to. Oh, please, she's got a rap. Let me just say this, Shirley, and I want to give you. I want to give you. I do want to give you your props for just one second. It's still, even though you're a religious nut job and you're going to funerals of fallen soldiers and protesting, it's still a nice step up from attorney.
Exactly.
Which, by the way, is a quantum leap up from publicist. So you do the math.
And casting agent. Exactly.
Yes, and casting agent. Thank you.
And a radio DJ.
Yes.
Where does that fall?
You imagine that you're something when you're nothing, hon. All that talk about your house and your car, get over it.
Yeah.
Get over it.
Yeah,
I'm
how about you getting
Nobody
over not having anything?
Your house and your car, hon.
It's interesting that people say, like, oh, you got to get over your big mansion and your sports cars and all that stuff. How about you getting over not having S? That's a bigger challenge. You know, if you think about
it. Au contraire, she has 13 kids. What are you talking about? She has nothing.
I know.
Arrogant.
I know. All right, hold on a second.
You have undeserved arrogance. You think you're something when you're nothing. You deceive yourself.
Right, not like you.
Doesn't have anything
firmly
to do
grounded,
with
by the way. Both feet on the ground. This one.
Exactly.
What about the irony that you are aligning yourself with Islam, with Al-Qaeda? Mm-hmm. You're essentially, this is what you're supporting then.
And of course, you're a liar.
Yes.
Why? You're supporting the dead. You're supporting that you're protesting. You're celebrating the dead soldiers. So who's killing them?
They use violent strategies. We use words.
That's right.
I see.
That's kind of a major difference, you dumbass.
That's right.
Well, you're celebrating the dead soldiers, aren't you?
Did you say dumbass?
I am thanking God for his righteous judgment pouring out on this earth.
Kevin?
And if you don't do that, you're a soldier.
Yes. Kevin is a Marine, by the way, in Iraq, was in Iraq.
Well, then Kevin needs to watch out for IEDs, because he's put himself in the crosshairs of a radio.
And you need to get an IUD, 13,
that's right.
Mother of 13.
Mother
11, of 13. Clown, 11.
11, that's not 13.
Excuse me.
Won't talk to you.
Yes, two aren't talking to you, I hear.
She can't count after the two hands.
There's a shocker. All right. It's 13 men. It's 11 kids.
I see.
You got to read the note card. Kevin?
Yes.
How say you?
Get a grip.
I say this woman is a nut job. I mean, how would she feel if somebody came to a funeral of her kid and was cheering the fact that her kid was dead?
Well, first of all, if my kid was dead, I would know perfectly well that my hand was involved in that because I didn't do my job to that child. And then I wouldn't give a rat's ass if someone was outside with a picket sign.
You would.
My number one priority and agenda would be to make peace with my God.
Mm-hmm. So you wouldn't care if somebody showed up at your kid's funeral.
Think
with
rat's ass. I wouldn't give a rat's ass.
Wow. Have you won the Mother of the Year award ever? She's curious.
I don't know what the heck the Mother of the Year Award is.
Well, Kevin?
What is that Mother of the Year award?
You're
Are
back.
You a mother?
You're back from Iraq?
Yeah, I'm actually out of the Marine Corps now, back home trying to go to college.
Uh-huh. Well, you're lucky you weren't killed over there, because Shirley would have been at your funeral.
Yes, you are. And you ought to thank God every day that he didn't...
Oh, trust me, I do. And God was the one that... I believe in God, and he kept me safe over there.
Sure.
And I want to know something else.
And so do you repay him by obeying? Do you repay him by serving him? Or do you repay him by standing around carrying on because we do?
Mm-hmm.
No, I do what I do because it's what I do. Now, I want to know. I'll ask you something. Mm. What do you think about the government administration?
Who are you talking to?
You.
What do I think about the administration?
Yeah, like the president.
I think that pompous-ass Banny Rooster Bush is exactly what this nation deserves.
Mm-hmm.
Bush is a
goddamn liberal. He really is.
A drunk, staggering in his own vomit.
Wow.
That's how we got duped into this war.
Message.
You know we were duped into that war. You know we were.
Yeah,
all of the counselors were given a lying spirit from the hand of the Lord their God.
Yes.
Yeah, but the president is a Christian.
He's not a Christian. Don't lie to me. I know better. You can say you're anything. It doesn't make it true.
Hey, Shirley, let me ask you this, though. Guys like Kevin, who fight for this country, essentially fight for an environment that makes it okay for you to speak your mind. You to go out and protest. Shouldn't they get some credit?
Do they get credit for what?
Do they get credit?
They have a job. They have a job. It's to serve the Lord their God with all their heart and all their soul and all their might. If they don't do that, they don't get credit for anything else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Rich has a question for you. But I'm just saying, shouldn't we give these guys some credit for keeping this country free enough so that people like you can go out and speak their mind?
Here's the answer to that. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it, and except the Lord keep the city. We wouldn't need these goofy soldiers if this nation would obey the Lord their God and have the Lord their God blessing them,
mm-hmm.
because he alone can keep this nation safe.
All right. Now, well, thank you for answering that.
These dummies haven't bothered to understand the first rule of war is to know your enemy,
mm-hmm.
and their enemy is the Lord their God. He's fighting against this nation with a strong arm and an outstretched hand.
This is confusing.
All right.
Through the soldiers of Islam, who you support.
All right.
No, he's also fighting against them, but he uses them like he did so many times in the scriptures,
mm-hmm.
and he calls them his servant to do this job, and he says,
Rich?
I will use them, and then...
Hey Adam.
Yes.
Shirley.
Shirley.
Osama bin Shirley.
Rich.
Shirley.
Rich wants to talk.
Shirley, I just wanted to ask you a question. I wasn't quite sure, but how much credit does the Lord give you with your second litter?
Okay, I don't even know what he said, but what I'm telling you guys is that
Well, basically, I'm trying to find out. You've already put your first litter out. That's 11 kids, so are you going to try to match the apostles and have 13 in your next set?
Yeah, what about the next go-round?
What about the apostles and the 13?
Any more children?
More kids? You said you don't give a rat's ass about the ones you have.
I'll have all the children that the Lord my God gives me, not one more, not one less.
Right.
Surely you can't be serious.
Dead serious.
Another
serious
quick. Brittany.
Yes.
You want to say something to Shirley?
Yes. What happened to honor your neighbor and treat your neighbor as equals?
Well, hon, how about if you just try to get the words close to right? It says, love thy neighbor as thyself. And it says,
okay, so do you not love yourself?
Are you going to let me answer the question, or are you going to keep babbling?
I'm babbling. You sound like you're babbling.
Because Shirley's concise.
The scripture says to love your neighbor as yourself, and then it tells you how you do it. It says you love
your neighbor. Okay, but you're obviously not doing that. You're honoring your neighbors to be mutilated.
Answer, so how can you keep blathering?
Shirley should teach gym. You know what I mean? She'd be a perfect gym coach at the junior high level.
It says you love your neighbor by warning him that his sin is taking him to hell, and if you do not do that, you hate your neighbor in your heart. So you see clearly, I follow the standard.
Right,
no, you don't. No, you don't. You're totally being hypocrisy. You're totally being a hypocrite. You're not honoring your neighbor.
I have a new theory, Brittany.
Uh-huh.
It's now dawned on me. This is a ruse. Shirley is, in fact, a gay male performance artist.
What are you going to do when one of your 11 children come to you telling you they're gay?
Hold on a second.
What are you going to do?
We're playing right into his hand. Do you understand, Brittany?
Yes.
Do you understand how this works? He's a gay male performance artist who has found a way to get more attention than dipping Jesus in urine ever could.
Right.
You know what I mean? This is a more interesting way. Showing up, the cameras are there, we're talking to him, we're giving the website, GodHatesFags.com out. This is a social experiment.
Kutcher's best punk
ever. This is
ever.
His best work.
And we're the suckers.
We're buying right into it. Wow.
Well, thank you for letting me speak.
You.
I have to get to work.
You do. Brittany, do you smoke a lot of weed?
Yes, I do.
I know that from your laugh.
I'd like to get together with Shirley and play some miniature golf on the weekend. She'd
the
be
same
a lot
way,
of fun.
I can tell Brittany smokes a ton of weed the same way I can tell Shirley was molested.
That's amazing. You're like
Thank
the weed
you.
Whisperer.
Yes, have fun. That laugh. You hear
Thank
that?
Thank you, Brittany.
All right, baby doll. What do you do at work?
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm a dental assistant.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. Giving people a contact high when you reach into their mouth. Lung pops out, lands in the guy's mouth. Oh, dental assistant. I'd rather get a job euthanizing the homeless, really, than standing around next to people. They're saliva everywhere, blood flying around. All right, let's say bye to Shirley. Shirley?
Yes, and if I had a child who came to me saying they were gay, of course they wouldn't do that. They'd sneak out under cover of darkness.
Sure.
And see the end of them.
Sure.
But it'd be goodbye.
That's right.
Okay. And
all
that's
right.
What I look for in a dental assistant is a crackhead.
Well, she didn't say crack.
I think it was pot, but drugs are drugs.
Whatever.
I agree.
Crack, pot, whatever.
Same thing. It's all the Lord's work, right? So, Shirley, we'd like you to be part of the show. You've really lit up the phones. I'm a fan.
Yeah.
And it's one of these things where, well, we'll agree to disagree, but...
How about if you just do your job and fear God and keep his commandments? Because this is the whole duty.
Listen, look at the glasses half full. This Shirley, she may have a lot of kooky thoughts, but one thing you know for sure, Carolla, is that she puts out.
Yes.
You know, 11 kids.
You know, is
she
right.
Must be wild in the bed.
Report. To you what the Lord your God requires. You know what? You're not going to embarrass me in that fashion.
Yeah.
The scripture says that marriage is honorable and all, and that bed is undefiled. I don't care if you do it swinging from the lampshades. Just make sure it's the wife of your youth.
Nice.
The wife of your covenant.
Right.
It's those two, that twain is no longer two but one flesh.
I know where you're going with the lampshades, but I think the chandelier would be a better thing to swing from.
Yeah.
The lamp doesn't
chandelier,
seem like it could hold you up.
Lampshades, whatever you want to swing
all right.
from.
All right, Shirley, we'd like you to be a regular part of the show. For that, we'll give you plugs like GodHatesFags.com.
Okay, honey. Well, is that all you want from me for today?
That's it.
I
want to
bang this Shirley. She'd be wild.
She's
fertile.
I say, guys.
Give her my juicy.
All right.
Bye.
Bye, Shirley.
Bye-bye.
All right. Let's see. Let's look. Turned
out to
be okay.
You can't judge people. People are people. That's all.
That's right. And that's, you know, that's why we call this the melting pot. We invite all the crackpots from around the world, then we all melt to the melting pot. Well, anyway, she had something to say, and that's my whole thing about this show. Whatever you got to do, just don't be boring. We'll have you back on. So, again, I disagreed with some of the things she said, but we'll have her. We'll have her back. You decide which ones I disagreed with. Def Rat Guy coming on soon. Yeah, he's looking at the paper. He can't see me talking to him. Somebody throw something. Jerron, throw a flip-flop at Def Rat Guy so he knows I'm giving him the thumbs up.
Wait till he gets a load of this Teresa.
He'll be up next after this.
Maverick.
Can't hear much, but he can still drink beer and party every day. Well, he likes chicks, sorority girls are always ready to play. Well, Moose gets Woody at the drop of a hat, but he says that he ain't bi. Just a fifth-year senior living it up. Hearing loss ain't a crime. Def Rat Guy,
everybody. In studio, everyone's favorite. We know him as,
what up, bro?
We know him as Jason. You know him as Maverick. That's his handle over at the TACS House. 50-year senior over at USC. What's your major?
I'm a communications major, but I have a minor in hotel and restaurant management.
And you would like to catch on here at the Adam Carolla Show, yes?
Hell yeah, bro. I really need a job because it's looking like I might graduate this year.
Oh, you may graduate this year after 5 years.
I have a meeting with my thesis advisor, and she says it's looking pretty good.
Okay. All right, so you write the thesis, you graduate, and then we try to find an opening for you here. But I got to tell you, we've been trying you in a lot of different positions. You did, I think you did the weather, you did the financial report.
Astrology report. And he did travel for us when he went on spring break.
He
hasn't been here for a visit
Just back from spring break.
Spring break was pretty good this year. A lot of stuff happened. Some stuff not so good.
What happened? What's happening?
Choked up about it.
Wow. What happened, Maverick?
We thought we met these girls that were really cool.
Uh-huh. Where were you? Were you in Cabo now, or are you at Havasu?
That was like 2 weeks ago. We met these girls. They were really pretty. Mm-hmm. They were exchange students, or so they said.
Uh-oh.
They said they were from Bulgaria.
Mm-hmm.
But they weren't exchange students. They were gypsies.
Wow.
They were from Romania. They ripped us off for everything. They stole our keys while...
Hold on.
So they stole our cell phones.
It's still new.
Why do you have a cell phone?
I have the thing.
He has it on vibrate, you pig.
I'm sorry.
And text messaging. Jesus Christ, David.
It had all my contacts in there. And my thesis advisor was calling me old.
Okay, obviously this is difficult.
Listen, you bitches.
Yeah, if they're listening, Maverick, if they're listening, do you have a message for them?
Screw you, you messed with a dick. You are going to get down hard.
Oh, I see. You might throw some pumpkins at their caravan.
Don't rip us off. We treated you. We bought you beer all night. We paid for your hotel room, and this is how you think of.
Did you at least get some, Maverick?
I got to second base. Poochie got lame.
What else is new? Poochie every time. He's the one that looks like Jeter.
He's a short Derek Jeter is what he looks like. All right, listen, hold on, Def Rat Guy. I know this is kind of emotional, and I'll tell you what, we got to take a break anyway because we're running behind. So this will be a time for you to compose yourself, okay?
It's all good, bro.
Okay, I know what it's like to be taken by gypsy women. Same thing happened to me when I was in junior college. All right, here's the point. You compose yourself. We'll take a break. Then we're going to come back, and you'll do a health report, okay? Def Rat Guy coming up after this. Wow. If only Def Rat Guy knew the song, the ironic song we're playing right now. Jason. We know him as Maverick, Def Rat Guy. He's a teak from USC, ripped off by gypsies, gypsy ladies. Probably Cajun queens from New Orleans, if I know my gypsies. Ripped the boys off. He got to second base, and now a cell phone, his keys, his wallet, all gone. So it was a very sad ending to a turbulent spring break this year.
As he now tries to move out of college and into the real world, maybe this is a powerful lesson about how mean the real world can be.
It can be tough out there, Maverick.
Oh, I forgot to tell you, I got sunburned so bad the doctor said it was second degree on my back.
Wow. Out at Havasu?
Yeah, I forgot to put on sunblock.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, you got to put sun. That's why they call it sunblock. Got the word right in it.
Maybe the gypsies took that, too.
He got drunk and you just passed out on a houseboat or something?
Yeah, that happened the second or third day.
You were drinking?
Hell yeah, we were drinking. It was spring break. We were getting wasted. On spring break, if you're not wasted, the day is...
I always love that. All right, so you're going to do a health report for us. We've been testing him out. Again, he's a fifth-year senior, so he's looking for a gig. Theoretically, if his thesis goes okay and he graduates soon, he's looking for a gig. He's looking to catch on here at the radio program. We've been testing him out in different slots. Now, how about a little health report from the Def Rat Guy?
The health report. We're not just talking about chicks putting...
What?
We're not just talking about chicks putting on the freshman 15. Right. U.S. children and men are growing fatter.
Oh, I see. Yeah, they're getting obese.
More than one-third are now overweight.
Mm-hmm.
And more of their dads are getting heavy, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm worried about Moose.
What happened?
He's getting really big. I mean, He makes Big Tad look like Nicole Richie.
Wow. Oh. He's a big guy, Moose.
Wow. He takes off his clothes because he says he gets really hot.
Mm-hmm.
And he gets all red.
Yeah. He doesn't get wood, though, does he?
No, but I'm really worried because he keeps...
Are you breaking down again, Maverick?
Worried about his friend.
Don't take that with the dog. You don't ruin my spring break.
This gypsy stole everything. Hurts.
I gotta tell you, let me just talk for a second, Maverick, while you compose yourself. This is more than just a vacation. This is a religious pilgrimage, spring break for deaf frat guy over here.
Moose, you know, and those guys. Sure.
Yeah, I mean, you F with that, and you're effing with a livelihood.
It's sacred time for us, and you took that from us. I will never forgive you. I will hunt you down like the dog that you are.
Oh, really? Going tough words for the gypsy ladies. Beautiful gypsy ladies. Stole your wallet during spring break. All right, if you could just compose yourself and focus on the future in the show. Let's not live in the past.
For the first time, scientists have rebuilt a complex human organ, the bladder, in seven young patients using live tissue grown in the lab. It's a breakthrough that could hold exciting promise for someday regenerating ailing hearts and other organs. Boy, I wish Smitty had another new bladder.
Top bunk?
From the top bunk every...
Smitty whizzed on you from...
Mm-hmm.
What?
Friday night.
We got the drop button hit on us there.
Like two for Tuesday.
Don't say it again, Bresca. We'll
you
get
know
dropped
what?
Again. Yes.
My bladder... I tested it. It can hold 9 brews. Mm. But that's down from 11 my sophomore year.
Wow.
Wow.
The next story is a cochlear implant may help the profoundly deaf.
Oh, wow. Close to home.
These are for people who do not benefit from traditional hearing aid.
Mm-hmm.
It is designed to produce hearing sensation by electrically stimulating nerves inside the inner ear. Mm. You know what? Yeah, right. I'll believe it when I see it. It's like Ashley, you know?
Which Ashley?
Oh, the Tridelt, you know, the one that looks like Misha Barton.
Not the one who shaved downstairs?
No, not the one shaved down below.
Okay.
But she said if I took pictures of a test, she would give me a Hummer and work and work my bag. So I get
what happened?
I get the test.
Mm-hmm.
I get suspended and and I get blue balled.
All right.
Wow. Listen, 1-2 punch.
It's been a really trying month for you, deaf rat guy.
But all I can say, I really need to graduate.
Okay.
Well, he acts all mad about everything, you know, like he's been ruined by women. But during the commercial, he was all over Teresa.
She's really hot.
Yeah. All right. Hold on a second. We have to wrap it up. We're running terribly late today. I think you did a great job on the health report. I know you're still broken up about what the gypsies did to you and Cubby and Moose and the rest of the boys. But hang with us. We'll do the news. We'll do the sports. You can kind of chime in. You know, just sort of see how you feel. See how you interact, how you fit in with the rest of the crew here, all right?
It's all good. Wait, I just want to have one more story.
Mm.
Many kids are too heavy now for car safety seats.
Right, right.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, that's it. All right. All right, Deaf Frat Guy. You know him as Maverick. He's going to be hanging with us. We have news. We have sports. Dane Cook calling into the show. All that after this.
Hey, this is Jonathan Anton, celebrity stylist from Blowout, and you are listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Listen up. You can hear the hair.
Mm-hmm. He's all about cutting heads. Jonathan, I watched him last night. He is awesome.
Not gay, though.
I love that show.
No, I do, too. All right, Deaf Rat Guy in studio. He's going to hang with us. He had a tough go of it this spring break. He was doing okay. Then they got thrown out of Cabo because Moose was throwing beer bottles off the hotel balcony into the pool. And you guys got thrown in the pokey and you had to sell your return flight tickets so you could get out of there. But Pookie, Pookie's the guy who looks like a short Derek Jeter. His uncle is nice enough to pick you guys up at the border and drive you guys straight through to Havasu, where the party continued. You got the sunburn, and then you met the gypsy chicks, and you thought they were 80 pies or something, or from another fraternity or sorority. Turns out they were gypsies that robbed you guys blind.
The first indication that things were not right. I didn't think that thetas would be foreign exchange students. That's not typical.
Right. Yeah, they were thetas. They were claimed to be theta foreign exchange students.
Yeah, Bulgarian thetas. Well, I mean, that's weird.
It didn't add up, but we were wasted, and maybe we wanted to just get a little.
Right, right. You did get to second base after all, but not worth getting your cell phone and wallet ripped off that way.
I just want to give a shout out to Poochie's uncle.
Mm-hmm.
You really came through. You really bailed us out, bro. This one's for you, dude.
Oh, well, again, getting very, very emotional this morning. All right, so hang with us, Maverick, because we're going to do some news and some sports. And, you know, just chime in. See how you fit. See how you mesh with the group. So, without any further ado, it's time for news with Teresa Strasser.
Well, tonight, one of the final nine contestants will be eliminated on American Idol. And I don't know, I think some of you follow Idol. So if you don't, you can actually bet online on American Idol winners.
Yeah.
And right now, Chris is 5-7 to win it all.
Mm-hmm.
Next is Catherine McPhee, 2-1 odds. And who do you think has the longest odds?
Longest odds has to be the guy with the Bucky.
That's right. 65-1.
Yeah.
Bucky to win.
He is a dark white trash horse.
How do you stay in such good shape?
Thanks.
Mav, let her finish
her.
Let her finish the news.
I am trying to do the news, but I appreciate the compliment.
Yeah, I was trying to keep a professional environment here. Yeah.
Thank you.
Too bad they can't do what Trump does every once in a while. Every once in a while on The Apprentice, Trump will toss off two people at a time.
Yes.
He'll do, you're fired and you're fired. They ought to do that on American Idol. They should throw three or four of those kids off after last night's performance. It was horrible, but it makes you realize just how bad country music is.
Yes. Even Mandisa, my girl Mandisa, didn't sound good last night. She's 6-1 odds, by the way, to take it all. Okay. Jennifer Aniston and Catherine Keener were on the Today Show yesterday promoting their new film. Things turned ugly when the reporter asked Aniston about a rumor that Oprah is throwing her an $8 million wedding. Now, her friend Catherine Keener sticks up for her. Here's Keener going off on the reporter, Jill Rappaport.
I just want to know if I'm going to the $8 million wedding.
You know? I thought you weren't going to go there.
Oh, I'm not. I just want to be
invited.
But
you did.
It's frustrating because those rumors do get out there. But it's nice to know that you have people to support you so that when someone like me asks a question, Catherine can bury me.
I didn't mean to.
She could just take her foot in my mouth and go, that was good. Catherine, Mama Bear, more like Mama Cougar.
I know, I'm sorry.
You know, you hear about an $8 million wedding, you'd like to be invited. Yeah. I've never been to a wedding.
Well, you won't be now.
Definitely not.
If, by the way, how many movies can Jennifer Aniston make? I mean, she must simultaneously be doing two movies at the same time. I know it sounds a little redundant, but is it possible that she just does movies? I mean, she's done like 13 movies in the last 4 months, and she's tired of answering the questions, but go ahead and hang low for a little while. Live off a little of some of those friends.
Take a break.
Bucks you've made. Yeah, just take a little break.
Take a little dip in Lake Jennifer.
Yes.
A second.
That's what I'd like to do.
See how the water is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Lastly, Sharon Stone took a flight from New York to Los Angeles with her son and his nanny. Stone sat in first class while her adopted son Laird and his nanny were stuck in coach. Stone's explanation through her publicist, first class was sold out.
Yeah. Well, let me say this. Hey, you're going to ruin a kid and a nanny. You put them up in first class.
Spoil them.
I said it yesterday. I'll say it again. Sharon Stone's vagina has jumped the shark. It's over. I saw some gray on it the other night, and I realized it had jumped the shark officially. Yeah, listen, I'm all right with that. As a guy who flies first class, I'm fine with the little people in back. And by the way, how old's the kid?
I think the kid is 2 or something. He's a toddler.
Ah, fine. Let him sit in that first class seat. Let the nanny sit back there, too. No problem with that. Mm-hmm. All right. Here we go.
Maverick, you seem to be looking at my notes in an uncomfortably close way.
I can't see that close. I need to get closer to you.
Maverick, your eyesight's just fine. You're fine. Let her alone. Let her finish the news.
Well, my hearing is not so good. My eyes are like an eagle's.
Really?
Eagle type
eyes. Smooth operator.
I do feel slightly undressed with your eyes.
Teresa never had a chance.
Just let it happen. It's the most natural thing in the world.
Thank you, Maverick, so much. I'm Teresa Strasser, and that was the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
The season for our national pastime is underway, and we're only 160 games away from the end of the regular season now. American League, the Angels lost to the Mariners in Seattle. Oakland beat the Yankees. National League, Giants and Padres were rained out in San Diego. First time that's happened since 1998. Good news is that now people will have 2 days worth of booze to lay down upon the ample-sized head of Barry Bonds.
Let me say this. You know why they call it pastime? That's not a compliment. It's like that's what you do. We're just kill time until football season rolls around. It's like we're in some perpetual waiting room at a dentist's office. And you know there's that magazine that you're not really into because they don't have a Sports Illustrated or a Car and Driver. So you're like, Latin entrepreneur. I'll give it a look. I'll give it a look-see. Kill 20 minutes. That's what baseball is. That's why it's called a pastime. It's just a holdover until we can get to a real sport. Let's go. Let's speed it up.
I hear you.
Let's just do 100 games this year. See what happens.
Dodgers beat the Braves, but the bad news is that the bum's new first baseman, Nomar Garciaparra, has been placed on the DL. And we were talking earlier about, you know, Goyim, who can't say, you know, they refuse to properly pronounce Jewish holidays. Like, what is it called? Chanukah? I mean, I don't know. Right. I'm not Jewish. It's the same thing with old people saying ethnic-sounding names. My old man is a Red Sox fan. Nomar Garciaparra.
Yes.
You hear it 18 times on SportsCenter a day, old man. And then once the Steelers drafted Ben Roethlisberger, and he's like, I don't know about this Roethlisberger. Like, listen, old man, this is going to go on for 12 years, hopefully, with him as our QB. I insist you learn to pronounce his name, please.
Yes.
So, NBA. Kings of Schwarzenegger lost, but they're still 2 games up for the last playoff spot in the West. Clippers came back from 22 down to beat the Nuggets. And lastly, because I know time is of the essence, I do want to pay tribute to Barry Bonds. You know, I, among many other people, have come down on this guy and said that he's a jerk and everything. But it turns out that, you know, I've worked on under the assumption that, like Darth Vader before him, he's now more machine than man.
Mm-hmm.
But in fact, he's capable of tears. Here's his heartfelt discussion about how tough it is being Barry.
I wish I could just walk away. Like, leave this game. You got this half of people that hate you. And then you have this other half that roots for you.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's 50-50. It's more 75-25 at best.
That's great. Being generous.
Who is the 50% rooting for him now?
I am.
In San Francisco, they put up signs, trade Barry. In San Francisco, outside the ballpark.
Yeah, reminded me a little of Deaf Frat Guy moments ago talking about the gypsy ladies that stole his wallet over spring break.
He thinks he has it bad. Try waking up with all your stuff gone. Your keys, your cell phone, pager.
No, we heard about it, Deaf Frat Guy. That's cool.
Yeah, but you got to second base.
Yeah.
Much like Bonds.
That's right.
These bitches even stole my thesis notes. How am I going to... You think that senior thesis is going to write it down?
Okay, listen. Maverick, please. We have to finish now.
I guess we did. Number one sport.
Maverick, this isn't a personal forum for you to get your wallet back. I'm sorry, we're trying to do a radio program here. I know it's still bitter and the wounds are still fresh, but let's compose yourself
and
if you want to be part of the show.
Teresa's knee, please.
Yes.
I'm a little uncomfortable.
The one thing I have to do, though, bro, I have to keep it real.
Okay, all right. Are you currently doing that?
I'm trying. I know it's important for me to get a job, but... Yeah. I have to keep it real, bro.
Okay, well, we're going to take a break. Any last messages to the gypsy women that stole the wallet?
Yeah, I will find you. And I will get
back with mine.
Okay.
And then thumb.
Wow. All right. If you're listening, gypsy ladies, we will take ourselves a break. Dane Cook will be phoning in after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now at 866-901-ADAM. Let's do this.
Yeah. Dane Cook, just been handed a note. His management cannot find him. So he's probably still sleeping or buried under Jessica Simpson. Who knows where he is? But he's not on our phones. We can't live in the past. We must move forward.
The people who are easier to get in touch with these days are the Al-Qaeda people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Transition.
Transition. I'll tell you, it is easier to talk to Al-Qaeda's number three man from Yemen than it is to talk to Dane Cook in this day and age. Now, we have, we spoke about this a few days back, that there's a gay Muslim organization. And as we've spoken about all the time, these guys that protest too much, the guys who tell women to wear the black burqas, the guys who hang out with other guys that will want to, you know, if you go to one of these extremist nations and tell them you're openly gay, I mean, pre-op, board-op, gay Bill would be strung up by his nads and put in the center of town, probably drawn and quartered if he'd announced his gaydom in front of these people, yes?
I'd have to go in a burqa.
You'd have to go in a burqa,
sort
yeah.
Sort of like some of Maverick, that frat guy's probably his frat brothers, you know, the ones that are like, queers better not put their hands on me. You know, those are the guys that are probably most likely to be.
Again, we've brought it up. There's been studies. They hook up tumescence monitors to a guy who claims to, you know, hate homosexuals. That measures the blood that flows into the penis. They show him gay erotica, and it goes off the charts. Always suspected, but now we know scientifically.
Now, any of you homos touch me, and I'll kill you.
I would also, when you go back and just listen to the audio of some of these terrorists, not the video. The video will cloud the issue. You see the guys with the beards and the AK-47s and the flag behind them. But just listen to the audio. There is a certain gay overtones to it. We now pulled this off CNN, Al-Qaeda's number three man. Just listen to this. Tell me what you think.
American infidels, we have captured three of your journalists. We demand the release of all prisoners from Guantanamo Bay. We will not settle for anything except full release.
That's his cameraman.
What is funny? We will take these hostages and we will put them in a hole. And Allah will think it is glorious. Yes, Allah will love American hostages in his glory hole. What is funny? What are you... Your mother is the whore of all goats. We will not
sure
go
translate,
soft.
Doesn't translate that well.
We will remain hard. Yeah. It is not fine we idiom. Who will bend. You will bend over. The ball is not in your court. We are the ones who handle the balls. What the wash me hell me nasir? Yell me avash mahamule. Yell me avash mahamale me alle.
It's beautiful language. Yeah. It's not the people, I've learned that. Is there any more? We have more comments from? Okay. Okay, just number three.
American
now.
Infidels. Your harbors are not secure. We will come to America through your back door. We will enter and violate all. You will rain hot terror upon your yellow spine. What is funny? Stop laughing at it. We will steal the wealth of America and wear it proudly like a pearl necklace. Fuck on your head.
Whoa.
And upon completion for their efforts in this fight, all Muslim warriors will have the light of Allah shine upon them like showers of gold.
Well, he sounds like my dog when he's pulling really hard and he's got the choker on. He gets himself worked up into such a lather that I don't even think those are words.
But it is
end.
Sort of gay, though, some of that stuff.
It is when you listen
I don't know.
To it.
You guys are reading in.
You think so?
I don't know if I.
Like I
that.
Said, when you see it on TV, you don't think about it because of you know, the visual
well,
imagery.
Maybe we need to hook Teresa's penis up to the tumescence machine.
Quickly, to the tumescence monitor. All right, we need to take ourselves a little break. We'll be back. Now, Teresa, This is your last day, so you're going to have to rank the guys.
Oh, really?
Yes. Think about it.
Okay.
Think about it. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. He's so hot.
Mm-hmm. Tim McGraw, Mimi Rogers coming in tomorrow.
Wow.
Yeah, she's a dear, dear friend. Oh, yeah. Sexy.
And Tim McGraw.
And Tim McGraw.
That's something.
Yeah. Mimi's married to Tom Cruise, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
We can pry a little
and McGraw's married to the Fox of Foxes in country music.
Faith Hill. Yeah. See if we can pry a little information out of Mimi tomorrow. Teresa Strasser is here. She's been filling in for Rachel all week, doing a great job.
Thank you.
This is your last moments on the show. So, we must ask you to rate the guys.
Okay.
Start at the bottom.
Ugh.
Be cruel. And let me just preface it with this. It's been done already. I mean, everyone can take it. Everyone's okay. A pro with a thick skin.
Okay.
Except
well,
for Damashek.
Can I start with the good ones? The attractive ones?
No. Start from the bottom and move your way up.
Descend from Coy Hill and speak frankly.
I'm not as good with everyone's names. But there aren't that many that are just really disastrous.
Really?
No. I mean, there's pretty much no one that I wouldn't go out with.
You would go out with Big Tad?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, I would go out with him once. I have a boyfriend now, but when I didn't, I would really go out with any
Let's
troll.
Do a little recreation, Dave. I'll be Teresa. You asked me if I'd go out with Big Tad.
Teresa, would you go out with Big Tad? Is that a yes?
Yes.
I'll say this.
I would have killed myself minute number three of if I was Tad.
I'll say this though. I do like a big guy because the bigger he is, the thinner I look, and there's something cuddly, like you could sit on his lap and everything. But
Dave asked me if Teresa's lying right now.
Teresa lying?
I've dated bigger.
Okay, you've dated bigger.
I have dated not bigger. Come on.
But you've dated big guys before.
Yeah, cuddly big.
Not a
football player big.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. He's not football player big. He's 6 foot sub consumer big.
Yeah.
Okay.
Who's next?
All right. Big Tad's at the bottom. He's the anchor.
Yeah.
It's fine.
Yeah. This is horrible.
Keep going.
God.
They can take it.
I mean, if you rated all your news girls, I would clearly be the lowest.
No.
So this is, I'm in
no
position.
You know why? Because I factor in personality.
Well, thank you. 2%,
but I still factor it in. Almost nothing, but I factor it in.
Thank
now,
God.
Don't you make the same mistake.
You know, I must say that I noticed immediately that Dave is a much better looking than I thought he would be.
Oh.
He's a very good looking
man. He's attractive man, yes. Yeah. He doesn't sound attractive.
Ultimately a dick, right, because I sound.
Right.
No, you're actually a super nice person.
But we're going in order.
Yes, I'm sorry. I skipped.
Oh.
You skipped. May I suggest Bill the board op, perhaps?
aside from what Shirley had to say earlier, I think God loves gay people, and as do I.
Mm-hmm.
So he wouldn't want to go out with me, but I think
you'd go. So
may
I suggest Brusca, the lesbian producer?
Brusca, here's the thing. Brusca is actually the type of guy that I would date.
Should I read you the specials?
Yes.
Yes.
No, but Brusca's the type of guy that would just be really good to you. Like, he would pick you up. He wouldn't make you meet at the restaurant, and he would
but
remember things you
like.
But
I'd be dead.
Till you got out of line.
In the bedroom. I'd
That's
be
right.
He would make you cook him breakfast every morning.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, he does do that a little bit. No,
yes.
he's sweet.
Until you screwed up brunch one weekday, and
then
you're out.
Then I'm out.
He's all got right. bigger bosoms
right,
than you.
Let's get to the rankings.
Let's get to the rankings.
Okay.
How about Jerron? Foxy.
Actually,
hot
he's incredibly
Jerron.
Good looking.
He really
as far
is.
As just aesthetics, he might be at
Great
the top
bones.
Of the heap.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not really kind of, I go for kind of a preppy kind of look.
Mm-hmm.
He's the best looking
All
guy.
Right, let's pace it up.
Let's order it. Put it in order.
Okay. So I
had at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we went Tad at the bottom, and then we went. Who'd I?
Gay
what's
Bill.
His name?
Gay
yeah.
Bill.
Gay Bill.
You got phone screener Brian over there in case you're looking to pad
oh, he's
out.
Cute. I forgot about him.
List. Yeah.
He's cute.
Well, then
I
can't all be cute.
He's all right.
Okay.
He's all right. Women, we're very forgiving.
Yes.
What the Mike? He's funny, and mm-hmm. funny is sexy.
Right.
Like, deaf frat guy was
Stop
hot.
Stop with the compliments. All just right. do the order.
Okay, sorry. And then,
we got Mike? Do we have Mike?
Yeah, I'm putting him above...
You
no,
have
I'm
to pick an order.
This is this has happened three times now. These two have tied.
By the way, yes. This is like her choosing the news stories this morning. She couldn't make up her mind.
Yes.
You got to start making a decision.
This is...
very decisive.
I just moved up, didn't I? Brusca giving you...
Yes, yeah, you've tied.
Brusca, you've suddenly fallen in the rankings.
All right.
I don't know, you've been rather right. abusive to me today.
30 seconds.
Okay, and then... Adam, mm-hmm. remember in the 70s when the Playboys would always be like a carpenter, like the Playgirls that would have got...
Yeah, the guy did something for a living.
Yes.
Yes.
That's why you're sexy, because you get the feeling you could fix something for me.
I could.
It's macho.
And yes. It's incredibly...
Yes.
You again
if only I could fix this segment. No. But yes.
Wow. Well, that leaves only one.
That's a crushing blow to my
Speaking of blowing.
Self-esteem already.
Dave Damashek.
Yeah, good-looking guy, but you mm-hmm. get the feeling he can't change your oil or...
So wait a second.
Well, why are you ranking him above me?
So I'm putting you below. I didn't go in order.
Oh, and interesting.
It seemed fake
Here
since Adam's show
Here we go.
To put Smart. Adam on top.
That's exactly
I really admire your candor. It took a lot of guts to come onto my radio show and rank me number one. I like that.
But you are the best-looking guy.
Really?
Let's face it.
Look, Dave, let me make this point. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but you're saying Dave is an attractive guy. I'm marginally attractive. He may be marginally more attractive than I am, but my home improvement skills leap me over him.
Well, my dad's a mechanic. You know,
I understand.
Maybe the Freudian
World's
thing.
Only Jewish mechanic.
You should
mechanic.
See what I can do with watercolors, though.
Yes.
You'll never find out now.
All right. Good. So, that's it. I'm number one. Again, a wise, wise woman. Can't wait to have you back. Nice job. Took a lot of guts.
Hey, I said Jerron was the best looking guy.
That's true. That's true. But he's an intern, so he falls down below me.
He can't help my career as much as you can, so
Plus,
suddenly he's not as good looking.
If you brought him home, your Jewish parents would kill themselves. Teresa Strasser, everybody. A fine, fine job all
Marvelous
week long.
Job. Thank you.
Marvelous. Tim McGraw coming in tomorrow. Mimi Rogers in tomorrow. I want to thank David Zucker. This is his music, right? David Zucker in tomorrow. Deaf frat guy. Teresa again. Nice work, baby doll. We appreciate it. We had a good time with you. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.